soul with more of you. Floods of joy filling my soul. Filling my soul with more of you. Floods of joy filling my soul. Filling my soul with more of you. Floods of joy filling my soul. Filling my soul with more of you. More and more and more of you. More and more and more of you. But more and more and more of you. More and more and more of you. More and more and more of you. More and more and more of you.
Father of our Lord.
eyes, we worship you. Oh Lord, we worship you. And very soon, face to face, we will behold you and worship you, and worship you, and worship you. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. I desire to behold you and worship you, oh God. I desire to behold you and worship you, oh God, and worship you. Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you, oh God, we worship you. And very soon we shall behold you face to face and worship you, oh Lord, and worship. I desire to see you as you are, oh God, to worship you, oh Lord, to worship you. I desire to see you face to face to worship you, oh Lord, to worship you. Oh God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you, oh Lord. Oh God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you, oh Lord, we worship you. Very soon I shall stand and behold you and worship, oh God, and worship you. I desire to see you and all of your glory, to worship you, oh Lord, to worship you. I desire to behold you face to face, to worship you, oh Lord, to worship you. I desire to see you in all of your glory, to worship you, oh God, to worship you. I desire to behold you face to face, to worship you. Oh God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. I desire to see you in all of your glory, to worship you, oh Lord, to worship you. I desire to behold you face to face, to worship you. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. Oh Lord, we worship you. Oh God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. Oh Lord, we worship you. And I can see Jesus seated at the right hand of the Father. I can see Jesus. I can see Jesus seated at the right hand of the Father, seated there for me and you. I can see Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father, standing there for me and for you. We worship you.
Almighty, we worship Him alone.
And he made me righteous. Oh, God is almighty, and we worship him alone. God is righteous. God is almighty, and we worship him.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, it's just good to be here. But I'm really not gonna talk about how good it is for me to be here right now. I'm gonna go ahead and interpret the tongues that you heard a few minutes ago as the Lord began to shout out to us. To praise him, to lift up your voice and praise him. See, people want to do it their own way, but if you learn to hear the voice of God, you do it his way, then you'll have a transition over into the realms of this glory, this thing that God describes to us about in his word, where there is all the access to the supernatural and to the spiritual, the heavenly realm. People, you don't get into these things by the volition of your own concepts and ideas. You simply get into these realms of heaven simply because you learn how to follow God, the Holy Ghost. You learn how to hear his voice. You learn how to move when he says move. People just think that, well, God's just going to do it whatever way we want him to do it. No. He's teaching us to be led by the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to follow the Holy Ghost. I tell you, there is a realm of heaven that you can access at any time. It's here right at this very moment. Some people can access it. Some people can't. Some people are just standing here and you're looking. It's as though that you're standing afar away from the temple beholding the glory. There's other people that can be right in the holies of holies beholding all this going on the inside. Now, I want you to understand, the beautiful thing of it is at least you get to be seeing something. The good thing is you get to be around, you know. Hallelujah. Not in another nation somewhere. Hallelujah. Praise God. But if you would simply listen to hear, listen and understand how to be mindful of what God is saying, what God is doing, and we've laid out those laws of the Spirit of life for you for over and over again, and we'll continue to do so. We've got all kinds of YouTubes on it. You can go and listen to them. If you listen to them, if you listen to them with hunger, because see, people listen with their head. They listen, in other words, they listen with trying to intellectually put the pieces of the puzzle together. It won't work for you. You have to listen with your heart because you're desperate to understand how to move over into a realm. You recognize first and foremost that there is a realm called the heavenly. There is a realm called the spiritual. There is a place where you right now could begin to interact with God in a far deeper way than what you've ever understood, because Father has opened up the door to all of His fullness for us, and this is reality. I don't care what popular Christianity has told you, what religiosity has expressed to you. I'm talking about what the Bible declares that seems to be so aloof from men. And there are very few people to model it. But I believe with all of my heart that God has got people in this place, and I'm so excited about some of the voices I hear in this place even tonight, because it's a voice that produces a realm of a heavenly, an access in the heavenly. It's a voice. It's the voice of the Holy Ghost being allowed to express Himself through you. And it's expressed, He expresses Himself through you because you yield yourself over to Him. You're never going to step into this realm unless you first and foremost believe that the realm exists. And that it goes beyond the religious ideas of men and beyond the religious concepts and beyond the intellectual ideas that you have of God. The intellectual ideas that we have of God are really very small. If we were to be saved by the intellectual ideas and the concepts that we have of God, none of us would make it. But praise God for His mercy. It's all about a heart love and a heart cry and a heart change that takes place at Calvary. However, Papa is looking for some people to go with him. You know, and it has a lot to do with the way that you respond to God, the way that your heart's set. You know, the Lord said there was about a little over 30,000 people gathered together, and it's an excellent picture of the way God sorts things out. And Father said, too many. He said, tell everybody who's fearful, everybody's got something else on their mind, everybody else got something else they want to do, everybody else who's got a field to plow, a wife to marry, a family to take care of. They're concerned about other things. Tell them to go home. And a bunch of people went home, and praise God, bless you. You went home. We still love you, and you're still part of the company. But they're not going to be a part of the exploits of God. They're not going to be a part of the miracles. They're not going to command the moon and the sun. They're not going to be a part of the exploits. Took somebody to captivated by the glory who says, the glory's all I want. Well, you guys go think about whatever you want. I'm just captivated by the glory. Joshua, who's captivated by the glory, doesn't depart from the tabernacle's door. Huh? That's really what it is. And the Lord said it again, and he basically pared it all out. Now he says, okay, let's see how they drink. Because I'm going to use the people who drink right. Father wants you to turn, teach you how to learn how to drink. Then just all right me. You sound like a country religious person. You know, because I'm talking about something that's far more than all right. It's something, Lord, I'm passionate for it. Look, I got a religion detector. I got one, okay? And I don't want that. I want hunger. I want passion. I'm going after something that wrecks people's life with Holy Ghost conviction, with reality and truth, not sit by the wayside, you know, cheering us on, saying, praise God, go, 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 but stands up and begins to engage in this wonderful, glorious realm. And I believe with all of my heart that you hear because of that reason. This is a threshing floor. This is a place where the wind of God blows and people come and make decisions in this place. People just think it's another church. Oh, I'm going to check this church out. No, God's checking you out, man. You got it upside down. He's checking you out. You say, I'm going to go check out, see whether or not I should participate with this thing, that thing, the other thing. No, you on trial, man. God's seeing whether or not he can use you. He's going to say, now let's see how they drink. There was 300 people who drunk, who was drinking properly. There is a drink that we can have right now. Jesus said, come and drink. If you're thirsty, you come and drink. See, there's a thirsty. There is a spiritual thirsty. There is a spiritual thirsty that is just always there. It's a spiritual thirsty that, like Isaiah describes, it will only be satisfied by the water that comes from the realms of the heaven. It only is satisfied by the water that comes from the realms of the spiritual. It is only satisfied by the things that are ministered by the Word of God and by the Spirit of God. It is only satisfied by the divine purposes of God, the intent of God for our life. Hallelujah. You know, Father was just, as he was saying a few minutes ago in tongues, and I didn't really want to stop and interpret for it to you at that time, because it was busting forth into a song that we just sang. He just simply began to cry out, saying, the realms of this spirit, the realms of the supernatural. I hope you don't have to go. I mean, I wish you didn't have to go. I wish you really didn't have to go. Really wish you didn't have to go. You know, it's just, you're just going to have to learn not to be moved by your problems, your circumstances, your baby's diapers, your baby's feelings, your stomach's feelings, your head's feelings. Listen to your people. God's got something to say to you that he wants established in your life. It's true. And you're going to have to learn how to pay attention. You're going to have to learn to hear the voice of God. Otherwise, you go on with defeat after next defeat and the next defeat and the next defeat, and you never know how to move in that realm. Because I'm telling you right now, only the hungry and thirsty can come here. Only the meek and lowly can participate. Only those who hungered after God and said, okay, Lord, I'll set everything else aside to seek you and to seek you alone. I believe that this realm exists. I believe that you exist and that you are and that you hear and that you're a rewarder of those who diligently seek you. Suddenly the scripture becomes more than just ideas and concepts. There's a place that you and I can enter into. The Lord says it's the realms of the spiritual, the realms of the heavenly. They just right there, the glorious lightnings and thunderings, if you would. The place where the Father has concealed himself, if you would, is there to access. As you begin to lift up your voice and shout and praise, as you begin to move with the Spirit of the Lord and you hear him, when he speaks and you're attentive to what he says because you're so desperate to hear his voice. That's what he said. Hallelujah. 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 So he said, praise. He said, shout. He said, lift up your voice and praise. He said, begin to praise. Begin to shout. I watched, not now, then. Then. At that moment. At that moment. But if you hear so many people, you're over it again. Okay, lift up your voice and shout, lift up your voice and praise. You say, well, I'm worn out now, I'm tired now. I don't want to shout now, I don't want to praise now. Well, that was the time that you were going to step into another place and dimension in him. Hungry, you're going to always be. Thirsty, you're going to always be prepared. You're going to always be ready. I just want you to understand something. I want you to know that as high and as far apart as heaven is from hell, and your concept of heaven and hell. Just imagine for a moment, just conceptualize with me the beauty and the splendor and the glory that is there standing in Father's eternal glory and the beauty of the best things that he ever brought forth and created with absolutely no interference from anything that belongs to darkness, or sin, anything that belongs to hate and all that we right now are shrouded with in this world that is under the influence of the prince of the power of the air. Contrast and compare that to a place of torment called the Lake of Fire, where not right now Muhammad Ali is screaming his head off in terror because he's burning in a lake of fire. I said that just especially for the people that are on the YouTube right now. Because everybody's got people, I don't care if you're a Muslim, I don't care if you're a Hindu, whatever you are, you can be whatever, a Buddhist, a religious Christian, and all dogs are going to heaven. No, they're not. All dogs are going to hell. all spiritual dogs, unclean, every unclean person. The only way that you're made clean and holy and acceptable to God is because, number one, you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, who delivers you from the spirit of disobedience, so that now you can learn to walk in obedience, so that you can be obedient to God. The only legitimate response to God's love is obedience. That is not my opinion. That is a declaration of the volume of the book. Hello. It's a declaration of the entirety of the Bible, Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. I stand on high ground, speaking on behalf of Father here tonight. And it's about time we parse this thing out. I mean, I'm in Kashmir, and I got a taxi cab driver telling me that we worship the same God because he heard it from America. I helped him to understand, no, we don't worship the same God. My God is Jesus Christ, the eternal, the almighty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha-pa-ka-ta. Somebody said, oh, are you a Jesus only? No, I'm not. I believe in God the Father, God the Lord Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Ghost. What difference does that make? He's God Almighty God. Jesus Christ is my God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And this is not about a religious thing. It's about stepping into a supernatural realm where signs, wonders, and miracles work. Signs, wonders, and miracles don't work just because you cross your fingers and hope so. Judge, signs and wonders don't work and miracles don't work just because you can quote verses of Scripture. Signs, wonders, and miracles work because you know how to move in the realm called the spiritual. You know how to enter into a realm, an access, a realm called the heavenly. Hallelujah. And that's what we're here to learn. That's what you're here to learn. That's why God's got a people like me. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Rabastaya. I was telling some people, we were just in a meeting, and there was some worship leaders there from very popular, famous, big, large church. And one of the girls there, her grandfather is a famous preacher and sits on Cho's board, and you know, and her dad's a great guy, and I'm sure they're all wonderful people, but she needed some help. And so I walked, you know, after I had read everybody the riot act and told them they need to get right with God for about 2.5 hours, I was praying for people, and I went by these girls, and I looked at one of them. I grabbed her by the cheek. I said, what's wrong with you? And she smiled, and then I said, where's your hunger? I looked across at those girls, you know, from this famous platform. I said, where's your hunger? They all left that night crying, offended and upset, need to go to counseling the next morning. I kid you not. But the next night, fire of God touched them. Third night, they're cleaving to me. Fourth night, I was being hugged so long it was causing me, you know, to feel a little awkward. They latched on. It don't take long for people who are willing to let the yoke be broken. Huh? I would imagine if that wasn't mandatory to come to the meeting, they wouldn't have come back the next night. They would have gone to people, and the people have said, oh, don't go over there. Oh, that's harsh, and that's mean, and that ain't of God. But because it was mandatory for them to be in the meeting, there's no way out. And the people that they were going to go counsel, they said, no, you just have to understand. One dear brother put it this way. If he wants to whip you with a whip, take the lash. Pretty radical, eh? That's pretty good counsel. Oh, yeah. Don't fly. Somebody said, don't fly in America. Were they from America? They were just happened to be in Zambia at the time. On a lockdown. An advanced missions training. And it was mandatory for them to come to leadership meeting. Hallelujah. Praise God. It was actually the revival meeting for that ministry. It was mandatory for them to come. And I'm making this point to you, dear people, is because God's got to tear down things so he can build it up. God's got to uproot things so he can plant. People just, oh, plant, just go ahead and plant here in my garden. No, I'm not planting in your garden with all your stuff. I'm going to pull all that up. Get all that out of the way. Father's got to move the spirit for you. You're going to have to get rid of the stuff. Listen, let me ask you this. How has the stuff you believe been working for you up to this point? Come on now. Huh? Well, if it ain't working, why don't you just set it off to the side and go ahead and listen to what we got to say here tonight. I'm going to tell you right now, God's not impressed with you. He's not impressed with me. He's impressed with Jesus. And he's invited us to come live in him. And there is a discovery of life called abundant life right there. As I was saying, as radical as a contrast between being in that glory and that splendor in the heavenly versus being in the lake of fire, so right now there is a contrast between the realms of the earthly and that realm of the spiritual, the realm of the natural and the realm of the spiritual that you and I can live in. And it's almost that dramatic. It really is almost that dramatic. And we want you to understand the beauty and the splendor and the privilege to just know him. I'm just to know him. Just to be able to worship him, to live for him, to walk with him. Hallelujah. Why don't you be seated? Because I've pretty much laid out for you the tongues and the interpretation of tongues tonight that the Lord gave. And I suspect that God the Holy Ghost would like to do a whole lot more tongues and interpretation of tongues. Amen. Because that's the way that the body of Christ is defined. Everybody's got their religious ideas of how the body of Christ is defined. It's not defined, but by the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it's how Paul defined the body of Christ, the functioning of these wonderful displays of the Spirit of the living God functioning through our life. But you and I have to make a transition. We've learned how to live out an earthly life. We've learned how to live respectable. We've learned how to live responsible. We've learned how to live in a way to where that, you know, a few people can tolerate us for a period of time. Some people can tolerate you for a long period of time, especially if they like your mother that loves you dearly, a few other folks. But Father, he wants to take us over into a place of transition, where we live under the inspiration of a glory realm that is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. Listen, you learn how to function in the anointing, and you won't be sick, and you won't be diseased. You'll live in divine health. Somebody said, can you prove divine health? Oh, not a problem. By his wound, we were healed. It's already been done. Listen, healing is the children's bread. I can go on and on and on. I'm not going to do that because that's not the point tonight. I'm just, you know, want to just put out for you there the benefits because there are multiple benefits, you know. Hallelujah. He daily loads us with benefits. I like to say he so loaded us with benefits it takes supernatural help to carry them around. However, people in the church, and just forget about the lost that people don't know, people in the church are so distracted with their stuff. They're not obeying God. Rarely are they really obeying God. Praise God, there's a little bit of obedience to show up for church on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. That's really like the high top shelf obedience to God. You know, pretty much. I mean, that's top shelf obedience to God. Church every night. Whoosh. I mean, but the reality of it is his Father's calling us over into a place of living in him and enjoying him to where that this wonderful display of his glory and of his power is just, it's not something that, you know, you've got to work up. It's something that just overpowers you, overwhelms you. I mean, living in a glory cloud of the fire of God is not something that is easily tolerated. You know, are you listening to me? It's something easily tolerated. It will just absolutely excite every cell in your body. Hallelujah. Ooh. Ha, ha, ha. I mean, come on. Listen, having rivers of living water pouring out of you is not something that you can, that you conjure up or that you work up. It's something, you know, that is a force of heaven busting loose from you, and it's you're either in it or you're not in it. And if you're not in it, it's very difficult to get in. And I'm doing my very best to help the Western world, beginning with the Abiding Place Ministry, to understand how to get in and stop doing your stuff. Oh, hallelujah. I'm going to labor. I'm going to do my best. I'm going to do everything that God has given me to do to stir you up by putting you in remembrance of these things so long as I'm in this tabernacle to lay out for you the spiritual laws of life to show you exactly what you need to do. And if you will do them, you will discover all of this realm of divine glory. And it's not, listen, once again, it's a force of heaven upon your life that it's not something that you're wondering where it's at. Or, you know, it's not something that you're, you know, trying to have. It's something that is a force of heaven, the divine power of God that has you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Now, I know that everybody pretty much in this place, you've tasted a bit. And I just praise God for everybody that's participating in the youth ministry, because you're growing from it, aren't you? Huh? You're developing, those that are participating in the youth ministry. And praise God for those who are coming to the women's ministry. And I pray that you'll just lay hold on the things that are made available to you. But there is a heavenly ministry that is happening 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And Father's looking for some people to plug into it. Now, you're going to have to cut some things off, and you're going to have to change some of your lifestyle things. And you're going to have to completely, totally change the way that you think. Huh? And you know what? Your ambition and your own concepts of how to move with God and your own efforts aren't going to get you anywhere. It's a place of just becoming just desperate and hungry for God, broken and yielded before Him, and obeying those things which He says to do. Because if you just simply obey God, He works a miracle for you. A simple obedience, for example, of calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ because you want to be delivered from this world. Calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ because you want to be delivered from sin. Calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ because you want heaven now. See, because there's a lot of misconceptions about what it means to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and what you're going to get out of it. Some people believe that I will call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and all I'm going to get is be a member in the club. I'm going to have my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm going to be good to go to heaven. Satan is going to be able to drag me into hell, and I continue on living my own life the way I've been living it. And somehow I, you know, work God in there and give Him, you know, some attention every once in a while, maybe once a week or whatever. There's various different concepts of it. Maybe they're not articulated that way, but certainly in practice, you can look at a lot of different expressions. Are you with me? But Father has a very different idea of what it is. For him, He says, I'm going to give you a life exchange. In other words, you've got to lose your life to have this new kind of life that I want to present for you, to you as a gift. And all you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and a miracle will happen in obedience to Him. Now, He says that you're going to have to be willing to now lose your life. He tells us we're going to have to learn how now to deny ourselves daily, take up our cross and follow Him if we want to be His disciples. And that is really where a lot of people fall off. I mean, you know, if we started with 30,000, we're down to 2 now. Ha, 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 ha. You can go ahead and be silent. I mean, because that's actually an appropriate place for you to be silent, because it's just too close to home, isn't it? Okay, I'd like to move you a little bit more here than that. I'd like to move you in the realms of the Spirit. God would like to move you in the realms of the Spirit. But if you've been moved by ice cream and popsicles and pizza and automobiles and gasoline and new clothes and your job and your disappointments and your discouragements, you're all shrouded with all these things, and it's hard for God to move you. We're going to have a fire fall upon you and peel you first, so we can get down to the heart of you and the life of you, that part of you that God, the Holy Ghost, can speak. And we're believing, I'm believing with all of my heart, I'm pressing into a realm of Holy Ghost conviction to where people will melt in the presence of the Lord. Whether they're accepting of Him or whether they're rejecting of Him, they're going to melt in the presence of the Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus tonight, you'll melt in the presence of the Lord. Too many people have been allowed to stand around and sit around and hear the fiery words of God proceeding out of the mouth of His servants, and it has not, they've not allowed it to change them. And thus, through their unwillingness to obey God, their hearts become hardened and their ears become gross and dull, so that they cannot hear, and thus they do not change. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not changing, if you look like you looked last year, I want you to understand that you're going to have to get before God and get serious with Him so that they can be broken off of you. Because the power of deception is something that is a terrible work of darkness against our souls, because it leaves us in a place where we cannot see our own need of Him. And we can be so deceived that we believe that we're right when we're wrong, and end up in a place where we don't behold Him. We're much further from that. In fact, we think we die and go to heaven, and we end up in a place eternally separated from God. I don't want anybody to run that risk. I want you to understand that your proper response to God's love is obedience. Hallelujah. 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 I just want you to understand tonight, if you're sitting there with a frown on your face, you're telling me, come and rebuke me. That's your message to me, and just help you understand the signs of communication. Amen. Because that's what you're telling me. You're telling me, so I want you to know what you're telling me. So it's not a one-way communication, okay? Amen. Hallelujah. Father wants you to understand how to interact with him. Father wants you to understand how to move with him. And you've got, and the first and foremost thing that you got to understand is that the way you do it's wrong. With three amens, four nods of heads, and 30 people looked at the ground. There's nothing down there. At least look up. Don't look down. He's up. He's not down. The wrong ones. Are you with me? Up. Look up. Huh? If you feel like that was right, you know, what happens is when as soon as somebody gets hit with the Word of God, they look down. But I want you to be hit with the Word of God in such a way that you're going, yes, I want that. Yeah. Not, oh, I'm embarrassed. You know, Father wants you to embrace. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the living God. Let me just real quickly just, you know, we leave in the morning. I leave in the morning at 3:30 in the morning to go to Cuba. And I'm completely and totally exhausted. Do I look like it? No. Good. Because I stay at the anointing. Hallelujah. You know, I tell you, people that come to church tonight because they're tired. I wonder what they're doing with their life. Are you worn out serving God? Are you worn out serving yourself? And that's really a big part of the difference of whether folks are going to move forward in God and lay hold of this realm. You know, come on, people. You're going to have to quit living your own life and telling, you know, and make believe. Just start, listen, I want you to get your heart into this. You say, okay, my heart's in. I want to get your heart more into the kingdom of God, more into seeking. I want you to get your money into this. If you say, my money's in, well, get more of your money into this. Okay? Because where your money is, that's where your heart is. Where your heart is, that's where your money is. I want you to get your life, your life within respect of how you're spending your time into this. I want you to get your passions into this. And you say, well, my life is in it. We're getting more in. My passion is in it. We're getting more in. I want your passions to be into this, in the realm to where that there is an overwhelming burden of prayer for the nation of Cuba, prayer for the things of the lost and dying world around you. I mean, just imagine this. I believe that there are Christians and maybe people of God, saints that are sitting in here, and you don't really have a deep burning compassion for the lost. You don't. That should cause you to be broken before God and say, Father, I have a spiritual disease. Because when you don't have the compassion for the lost the way Father has compassion for the lost, you have a spiritual disease. There's some spiritual problems. There's a spiritual disconnect. Right there showing you, wait a minute, here is a symptom of an issue that's going on in my life that is part of why I'm not able to touch that realm. What's the cure? The cure is you begin to bring it before the Lord and you say, Father, I want to be able to love like you love, have the compassion that you have. I want to be able to see things as you see them. I want to be able to hear the way you want me to hear. I want to be able to respond obediently to your word. I want to understand, why is it that I'm not able to function in divine compassion? Where is the limitation that I've drawn on you to where that your love is not able to fill me as you desire to? The Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you're not able to function in my life and flow through me the way that you've ordained it to be. What is hindering me? And if, when you begin to do that, when you get real with God, he'll get real with you, because he's a God of truth. He's not a God of pretend. Yes. There's a lot of people that is, what they'll do is they'll just go ahead and they will self-justify their life. And now all the things about their life that are very different from the Word of God, somehow they just write it off, ignore it, and don't deal with it. Well, I'm telling you right now, you're going nowhere in the kingdom of God that way. And at best, you're the fearful that go home. You're the people that, you know, got other things to do, other, you know, issues, other concerns, you know, other interests. And you're never going to be a part of those that are going to be functioning in the exploits of God. And I mean, I can't imagine a person who wants to be left out of the exploits. I mean, wow. I mean, what? You're going to do what? You're going to go home and be bored with your stuff? And people, if there's ever a time that we need people right now to get involved in the supernatural signs and wonders and miracles, the exploits of the of just the interaction with the Spirit of the Lord, where these wonderful bursting force of the river of God, this Holy Ghost compassion, where you can't turn a deaf ear to a need or a blind eye to a lost person. You're not willing to function in your own, you know, ability in trying to reach out to them either. But you know, in fact, I really don't believe that you can have one at, you know, one is going to be without the other, okay? I believe that if you're allowing the love of God and the divine demeanor of God, the compassion of the Holy Ghost to function through you for the lost, okay, that you're also going to have the divine power and ability to speak the word of light to them, and the lightnings of God strike their heart and change them. This is true. This is true. Hallelujah. Father wants to change every dimension of your life and the way you function. What happens is people get on the guilt trip. They get on the guilt trip. Oh, I got, oh man, the pastor's talking, and you know, I just feel like I'm just like, you know, really a loser, and because I haven't been reaching anybody, and I don't really move with compassion, and so, you know, I got to try to work it up, and then I'm going to go out and I'm going to try, you know, to start talking to people about their soul and their, you know, their lost state, and it's, you know, it really amounts to nothing. It's just a conversation that's a dead-end road. It doesn't do anything to help anyone. Well, the private response is when you recognize, wait a minute, there's not the right disposition is not taking place in my life. The right response to God, the Holy Ghost, doesn't have it evidence. The compassion's not there. The love's not there. I can walk by people and feel nothing. I mean, when we walk by people, there ought to be a tractor beam. This says, what is the condition of your soul? Where are you at? Who are you? I love you. What is your need? Rather than just being able to just, because we live in a world right now, my goodness, I mean, they'll run you off the side, they'll run you off the road. I mean, they'll trample you in a line. I mean, the concern, I mean, this, you know, come on. The selfishness and the lack of, you know, any interest beyond the realm of self is rampant. And that's just the course of the world. That's the disposition of the demonic realm, the human realm. Father, his concern for a lost and dying world has been evidenced to us by the person, the Lord Jesus Christ, and all that he did and all that he said and all that he accomplished. And he says, come follow me. I want you to take up your cross and follow me. Well, what does that ultimately do? It's ultimately going to work out in the way that I feel about people around me, the way that I express love, the way that I'm not willing to leave them as I found them, the way that I'm empowered now to move by the authority of the Holy Ghost to drive out sin, to drive out sickness, to drive out disease, to drive out torment. It begins first and foremost with just love and compassion for a lost and dying world. Hallelujah. Something that you're going to have to learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. Because if you think that you're going to have this on your own and you're going to produce this in such a way that pleases God, well, the Mormons do a pretty good job. But I'm telling you right now, it's not what pleases God. The Jehovah's Witnesses do a pretty good job. I'm going to tell you right now, it's not what pleases God. I could go on with the list. And I'm going to tell you right now, I would not want the dynamics of what goes on in my life to look equal to, and certainly not less than, a Mormon's expression. Or equal to, and certainly not less than the Jehovah's Witness. And that's a pretty high bar. That's a pretty high bar. Pretty high bar. Huh?
Yeah.
It's a pretty high bar. Have you, I mean, think about the time that is placed upon them and the responsibility that is placed upon them. And I could go on and on. I could talk about the Muslims, and I could talk about their religious commitments, and I could talk about the Buddhists, and I could talk about their religious commitments, and I can talk about the Hindus, and I could talk about their religious commitments. And I mean, once again, there's some pretty high bars there in the way that they give of their finances, the way that they give of their time, the way that they give of their devotion. Those are some pretty high bars. Are we just another little religion set on the shelf? Hold up. Without the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, the answer is yes. Without the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, without you and I learning how to yield to the Spirit of the Lord, without you and I learning how to respond in obedience to Him and step over into that realm called heavenly, to begin to move in the Spirit, to begin to flow in the realms of the heavenly, to drink of that which Father supplies to us spiritually, so that out of our belly flows forth the love that only the Holy Ghost can express, the compassion that the Holy Ghost can express, that ultimately brings us to a place where when we walk by somebody, it's not, oh no, I got to tell them about Jesus because it's my religious duty and obligation. It's a tractor beam of divine grace and power that's got you. And now you have a place of divine authority. You're not sitting there all self-conscious, nervous about what you're going to say. Have an icebreaker, or did you hear what Trump said today? Or whatever icebreakers you know, people have these icebreaker concepts of how you have a conversation. Forget about that, man. That's just human. That's human. Father's calling you to a place tonight to change. When He calls you to a place to change, He empowers you with the ability to do it. If you want to sit, if you want to duck and run and go hide in the place of self-consciousness and self-interest and pride and shame at the voice of the Lord, then you have the choice to do that. But shame on you. But rather at the voice of the Lord, you come running because you're passionate for Him and you want that. I want that. You say, I want that compassion. I want that divine love through me. I want that tractor beam thing, man. I want to have that authority. I want to have that divine outworking of God in my life. I want it. Listen, when you allow God to move in your life, it's supernatural. It's evidence to be supernatural. It's supernatural. Somebody who's sitting here on the couch wondering why nothing happens. Exactly. Because you're sitting there on the couch and nothing is going to ever happen. You have to obey God and start moving in a surrender towards Him. And beginning to understand just the fellowship and the relationship that is there. You know, many people are faithful to church, but the church, what happens in church doesn't have an outworking at home. That doesn't carry over with the hunger to begin to communicate with God in a place of intimacy and prayer to where you touch heaven, heaven touches you. I mean, that's like pulling teeth from a chicken to get people, to get God's people, to set a time, a consistent time aside on the daily basis to where that they touching heaven. That's going to make the difference to your people. Giving yourself to the Word of God, to where the Word of God every day, where the Word of God touch, it goes beyond just an intellectual thing. Father wants to make it a heart thing to where, I mean, you're just reading the genealogies and you're touched by the Holy Ghost. And Bastikire Masta La Matera Dea begins to gust out of you. Taramasta. It's not an intellectual stimulus. Oh, this isn't an exciting passage. No, it's the Word of God. It's fellowship and communion with the Word of God that begins to develop your senses. It's coming to a commitment to where you obey spiritual laws and you run off all everything that is contrary to praise and thanksgiving. We've already told you that you're supposed to get up and dance around in the morning and worship God until your happy comes. Hallelujah. But you know what? You did it for 1 week and forgot after that because you got distracted with your car and with your clothes and with your job and with your busyness and with your stuff and with your chessboard and with your computer screen. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And worse than that, with, you know, your television or your CD player or your little iPod, you know. Are you listening to me? With all your stuff. No, Papa wants to fill you in such a way that his filling you fills all the things that you're involved with. Hallelujah. Pokorasita la mahate. Hallelujah. And as that, now we've got a place of growth and maturity going on in the context of relationship. The deal is this. God's covenant deal is this. He says, come and abide in me and I in you. He says, come and dwell in me and I dwell in you. This is what He says over and again. If I just take with you for you tonight, and I want to do this real quickly, and you know, I'm going to go home kind of somewhat early tonight, I think. I really do need some sleep. The body is still earthly and my tabernacle of clay. We went to lay down the other night because we finally got home, we got in our bed, and I'm telling you, every muscle in my body was trembling. Just so tired. And you know, Father, in His grace and His mercy, He gives us great rest, okay? Because I'm gonna tell you right now, I said in my heart, many, many years ago that I was going to fully know and fully live for God. I was going to fully know God and fully live for God. And I've had many things, as many as you, maybe more, distractions come along the way where I could have got involved in this and that and the other thing, and I would have had all the legitimate reasons, just like you have legitimate reasons, to be involved with them. But I said, no, I'm going after Him. You have to decide what you're going to do. Okay. Now I didn't leave my. Look, I'm going to tell you right now. I didn't get up and forget about lunch at work and go out and reach out to lost and go find the lost and the dying. Go seek the Lord because it was a religious obligation. I had the tractor beam thing going on. The love of God and the compassion of God still filled me. I wasn't doing it out of obligation. I wasn't feeling bad about myself if I didn't do it. Huh? Come on now, people. I want to help you understand relationship. I want to get you out of the depression and the guilt and all the other shame and all the condemnation and all the issues that burden you and berate you and condemn you. Come on, man. I want you to get over here into a place of praise and thanksgiving and rejoicing and delighting in the Lord your God, talking to Him and let Him talk to you, being filled up with His Word, being comforted by all that He's given, recognizing that He the Son sets free is free indeed, understanding the wonderful realms of living in this divine glory of oneness and unity with Him, coming, having the privilege of dwelling in Him. Hallelujah. God is holy and He made me holy. I pray that sticks in your head and change your whole everything about you. Or the way you think, or the way you do things. That when you go to do your normal everyday thing that God's not in, all you can hear is God is holy and He's made me holy. God is righteous and He's made me righteous. God is almighty and I worship Him alone. I'm in Him and He's in me. I'm in Him and He's commanded me to be. If you would just live that. I'm going to tell you right now, that jerk you up, that stuff's been keeping you sequestered from God the Holy Ghost. Been limiting your relationship and moving forward in Him. Oh, mandarabastaya. Hallelujah. Come on, people. Somebody said, well, I brought someone to the Lord once. Come on, people. Father wants to make you fruitful. Father wants to produce within you and through your life His wonderful display of His goodness, of His grace, and of His mercy, of His forgiveness, of all those things that was Christ Jesus died and rose again and ascended up on high for us to have. All you and I have to begin to do is to say, wait a minute, there's relationship problems going on in my life and I want them fixed. There's spiritual laws being violated and I want to violate them no more. I want to understand the rules of walking in a proper response to God's love. A proper response to God's love is obedience.
Amen.
There is no other. The Father says it over and again, especially, you'll hear it especially between John chapter 13 and John chapter 16. He says it a dozen times. But it's really the theme of the whole of the book. So I want you to open your Bibles with me to John chapter 15. Hallelujah. You know, I'm just looking for some people that are ready to run to the nations. But hallelujah. You ready, girl. You ready. I heard you preach. You know, the anointing is there. The power of God is there. Amen. Hallelujah. You too. Hallelujah. Karabasata karana. You ready. You ready? I want people to go, you're going to have fire in your belly. Amen.
Amen.
And signs and wonders in your hands. Come on, man. I'm telling you right now, we're here to teach people. But if you're going to sit in here and do things your own way, you know what? Give yourself a break and give us a break. Because the reality of it is I'm not interested in men's way. Okay? If you want to outrun me to the throne room of heaven, come on, bring it. I like to see it. Come on. Otherwise, get in and let's go this thing together. Come on now. Come on, forsake what it is you're doing. God has given us a mantle. He didn't give us a sheep to perfect us. You did notice that?
Yeah. Yeah.
The Lord gave to us people from another church to come in and perfect us. Did you read that in the Bible?
No.
Raised with another belief system and idea and certain notions of sincerity. No, He said He gave us apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, special giftings.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So let's just obey the giftings. Let's follow the leadership. Let's go ahead and step into the mentorship. Praise God. The mentorship of the Holy Ghost. because it's his mentorship. It's his word going forth. It's his life and power. If we just buck up against it and say, well, that's just man. Listen, we thus judge, if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but unto him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we now know no one after the flesh. Even though we knew Christ Jesus after the flesh, we know him no more. But if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are new, and all things are of God. So reality, what he's saying is this. We know no one after the flesh, but after the new creation. We understand now the divine order and the working, the operation of the Holy Ghost. And we're going to understand how to everyone be submitted one unto another. Everybody understand how to esteem everyone better than themselves. And everyone understand the mentorship and the authority and governorship of the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastors, and teachers. Understand the house order. Because I'm going to tell you right now, there is a lot of folks that don't even got the order. They don't even have the very fundamental basics of the foundation to build the house of relationship, of interaction with the Holy Ghost that I'm describing. And you can do all the other stuff. You can pray and you can fast and you can seek God, but you're not doing what God's called you to do in simple obedience and the foundational principles of divine order in your house and in your life. It isn't going to profit you anything. Because people want to basically skip over chapter 1 and jump to chapter 11. No, you get chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3. It's all prerequisite. Hello. Don't get nervous on me. Don't start getting all jerky and jittery and twisty. Because that's a manifestation. Sit up straight and listen to me. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, I'm going to sort you out.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
From the front row to the back one.
Yes.
If we could just understand, I mean, Ruth Anna posted today, if you wonder what Jesus would do, taking a whip and driving people out of his house is within the proper response of something like that. But at any rate, dear people, if we really understood the zeal that Father has to glorify the name of his only begotten Son and the responsibility that is on the church to do so and his response to our unwillingness to obey him but want to do it his way in his house. God is a jealous God. You need to take a look at him in Revelation chapter 1. Jesus is standing there. His eyes are on a flame of fire and out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword and he's talking and dealing with his church, not the world. Listen to me. And I'm going to get everything in order here. I'm going to jerk some of you around.
Amen.
And you can leave offended and cry and whatever you want to do. Huh? But if you come back, if you'll come back right, God will, I'm going to tell you right now, God will change everything. I'm done with playing patty cake games. I'm done with just acting like I don't notice that you feel like you've got something to add here. Are you listening to me? You have nothing to add. You need to submit yourself to the Holy Ghost and let God the Holy Spirit be manifested through your life. Because he alone is all that Father's looking for. He alone is all that is allowed in the midst of his church. His expression through our lives defines the body of Christ. Because the body of Christ is defined by the manifestation of the Spirit that is given to every man. But you're going to have to learn how to yield. And you're not going to yield when you try to skip over the divine principles, the divine order of God. Listen to me. Listen to me. We have got to see in the United States of America, we have got to see the movings of the power of God that is only going to be expressed. The only possibility of their expression, brother, is when the church of the Lord Jesus Christ begins to move in the divine order that Father has set forth for us to move in. And simply, once again, I'm going to say it again. The proper response to God's love is obedience. And when I say that, I know everybody's got their various different notions of what obedience is and their wonderful one-on-one relationship with God. Listen, I want you to understand, yes, we do have a one-on-one relationship with God, but it is first and foremost defined in the context of our collective relationship with God as the church, as many members joined together in 100% union with one another and submission to one another and love one for another. Hallelujah. That describes that you have been born again.
Amen.
The biggest thing that stops the church right now is suspicion, critical thinking, rebellion, stubbornness, the defiance that comes that is taught to people in the Western world beginning in preschool. Taught to them. They are literally indoctrinated in these kinds of things. Strife, envy, division, jealousy, all of those things that really run interference with the Holy Ghost. And it actually works in people's mind as they sit in the meeting. When I'm correcting my children, they're not going to be sitting there going, is he talking bad about me? Is he talking to me? He's talking to me, isn't he? They're going to be going, I need to get myself right. Are you listening to me? Praise God. I want you to understand, everybody, right now, I want you to understand, from the dynamics of the church, you are children being taught of God. Hallelujah. And Father places giftings in the church. I mean, it might be really advantageous for you if God had decided to put a 40-foot angel here to talk to you, whose fingers reach to the back row. That might have been very advantageous to you in terms of knowing, well, this is really God, and I need to really listen up. And I have not really got too much opinion in here. I mean, come on. You'd be sitting back in fear and trembling going, not the critical idea, you know, division and complaint and all the rest of that stuff wouldn't even enter in. It's just, but he didn't choose to do it that way. He chose to take one among you and anoint them. And it may be the least favorable, because not many favorable are called. Not many mighty, not many noble. No, but God takes the weak things and the foolish things. Huh? Yeah. Paul said, we're the scouring of the world. We're the outcast of the world. We're those that belong to the misfit island that God took and chose to speak through, that he might bring to nothing the wisdom of men. Huh? Yes. We're going to have to understand not to know anything after the flesh anymore. Amen. Why? Because we understand that we've been brought into another realm, a new creation. We're born into the Spirit. And now there's the dynamics of what God the Holy Ghost chooses to do, because he manifests as he wills and he operates through our lives according to his design and his desire. Hallelujah. It's us. It's what we got to do is wake up and come to understand what it is he's doing, because if we don't, we're not going to hear his voice, and we're not going to follow forth in his plan, and we're going to lose out on the beautiful things that we could have always been walking in, the heavenly realm that is far beyond anything that is earthly, living in a continual busting forth of the presence of God to your life as though they were rivers. Living in the crown of glory, get knocked down under the power of God, and you never left your living room. Hallelujah. Hey, you know where to just go stand over by your bed, because you know you're getting ready to touch that round, for a soft landing on the bed, right? Hallelujah. We're hearing the voice of God is nothing. Hearing the voice of God is nothing difficult. It's something that is just common and ordinary, and you love the voice of God in your life. You love the instruction. You love the wisdom of the Lord. One of the greatest, glorious displays of wisdom in a person's life? Walking in humility. It's a display of wisdom. There are many characteristics and many attributes of people's lives that display wisdom, that they are walking in wisdom, that they have the wisdom of God. We ought to recognize, wait a minute, we've received the Spirit of the Lord to the full. We've received the Spirit of the Lord and the Spirit of wisdom and understanding. We've received the Spirit of counsel and might. My goodness, might? Whoa. We receive the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. These things are just here. They're available to us. There are having them and responding to them has characteristic displays, demeanor displays, attribute displays, dispositional displays in their life. You can't fake it. You can say all you want. You got this, that, and the other thing. You know what? The behavior, the manner, the deed, the activity of your life displays whether or not you're willing to walk in the Holy Ghost and move by that which those wonderful graces that he's established. I am dedicated to making sure that every person in this place understands how easy it is to move in the Holy Ghost. To quit doing your own stuff and start doing His stuff. To quit depending upon your own thinking and start going with His thinking. To start to throw down or cast off, as it were, your own realms of understanding. And be clothed and put on and be endued with the mind of Christ. Hallelujah. Yeah. To put on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And you know, it's easy to understand if someone's put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Because when you put on the Lord Jesus Christ, you've made no provision for the lust of the flesh to fulfill it. Because you're overwhelmed with a divine disposition of heaven and pleasures forevermore filling you and gushing out of you, and you don't have any room for the rest. Come on, people. I'm talking to you about real, genuine, clear manifestations of whether or not you're doing it right, or whether you're doing it wrong, whether you're walking with God or you're walking your own way. If I spent time just taking you through the first epistle of John, there is no greater detailed epistle on helping people understand whether you're in darkness or in light, in truth or in a lie, in God or in Satan, in born again or still a child of the devil. He lays out clear, objective proofs. Says, if you're doing this, then you're of God. And if you're not doing these things, then you're not of God. If you're doing this, you're born of God. If you're doing that, you're not born of God. Then all of a sudden, people got a very clear understanding of, wait a minute, I'm allowing stuff to go on in my life that is evidence of something that is contrary to being a part of the family of God, living in the Spirit, being those that are born of God. And then that should be enough, people, to drive us back or draw us back, maybe better. But I'm like drive. I'm like drive. Huh? Somebody said you don't drive sheep. You haven't been around them. Somebody said you lead sheep and you drive cattle. Yeah, that's your fairy tale book. I guarantee you. Yeah, you're going to have to drive some sheep. And praise God for the Holy Ghost. Praise God for His Word. Praise God for His ministers. The Lord needs witnesses in the earth. Not false witnesses, true witnesses. Witnesses that can only be produced by those who have been endued by power from on high and are walking in the Holy Ghost and being led by the Holy Ghost. And you're not going to walk in the Holy Ghost and be led by the Holy Ghost and be all arrogant and stubborn and self-willed. Right. True. Is opposite to who He is and what He does. God, the Holy Ghost, produces meekness. He produces lowliness. He produces brokenness. He produces humility. He produces a person who is a servant of all, who obeys whatever instruction is given, who is not self-willed. I'll go on and on. The character of the living God, the Father, has given to us all of His divine power because He's called us to walk in His life and in His godliness. By His divine power, He's given us His life and His godliness so that we could walk in His glory and His purity. And He tells us how to be very focused on that. And you've got a world that's battling against you, people. I want you to understand, fleshly lust is a war against your soul. And you're going to have to understand how to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. You're going to understand that before you're going to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might, you're going to learn how to be filled with the Spirit. And if you're going to learn how to be filled with the Spirit, you're going to learn lowliness and meekness. You're going to learn how not to be self-willed. You're going to learn that every form of stubbornness and rebellion works counter to your yieldedness to the Holy Ghost. And that's primarily revealed in your interaction with people around you of authority.
True.
True.
Even authority set up like that we have in the system of the world because they were ordained of God, Romans chapter 13. True. But how much more the authorities He sets up in His church? How much more the authorities He sets up in the house? That's why moms and dads do their children a disservice when they do not teach them unwavering obedience. They do them a disservice. They just let them choose whatever they want to choose. What a disservice. They're not learning how to obey the authorities, how to submit to the authorities. They are literally being handicapped. They're being made dysfunctional when it comes to moving in the Spirit. But if we walk in God's way and we raise our children as God has described, we then become that much more closely, you know, related, if you would, or that much more able to be taught how now to go ahead and submit ourselves to the Holy Spirit, how to honor Him, how to obey Him, how to move with those things, those divine principles that He's set up that are absolutely essential for us to have what He wants to give. We don't have to beg God to give us the things that Christ Jesus died for us to have and rose again, but we have to learn how to yield to Him to receive them. Amen. He's pleading with us to have it. It's God's divine will, but you and I are going to have to understand that if we don't give ourselves to these things of the Spirit, the Scripture says we got a mind-blinding spirit. See, we think that mind-blinding spirits only belong to the lost. That if our gospel be hid, it's hid from those whom the God of this world has blinded them, lest they should see the glorious gospel and be converted. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, starting verse 4. But when we go over and we read in 2 Peter chapter 1, we understand that if you lack these things, you are blind. You blind. You've got a mind-blinding spirit. You blind. You've been spiritually blindsided. You've allowed through disobedience, disobeying spiritual laws, you've allowed a stronghold that has created a spiritual blindness in your life, and you forgot that you were purged from your old sins. Huh? But if you, the Scripture says, but if we do these things, hallelujah, if we give all attendance to making our election sure, then what Father's going to do, what is the result? The result is then we're going to learn how easy it is to step over into this heavenly realm that the Lord was addressing with us tonight in tongues and interpretation in tongues. We're going to learn how to respond to His voice because there's movings of God that if we recognize the time and the event of His movings, then we step over into participation with Him in a way that He ordained. But when we want to do it our own way, when we want to cross over the Jordan, when we want God to move at our convenience, we're not learning how to move with the Spirit of God. We're not learning how to move in signs, wonders, and miracles as He's ordained them, as He wants to lead us and guide us into. We're learning the opposite. So the Father's working to train us. He says, I've got my movings. I want you to move with me in my movings. And then all of a sudden we discover that spot. We discover that realm. We recognize that realm. Oh, this is a moment in time to move with God. This is a moment in time to shout. This is a moment in time to pray. This is a moment in time to do this or to do that as the Holy Spirit leads. Then it always works. We always have His divine results. So we're going tomorrow morning and believing God for miracles, signs and wonders and miracles. To meet with Raul Castro. And after having met with Raul and seeing divine favor there, to go and pray for Fidel, who's sick, because I want him to go to heaven. I want him to be born again. My goal is to let Raul know and to let everybody interfacing before I get to Raul that I've come to them with a message from the King of Kings. Yeah. From heaven. So you say, well, that's a lot to do. Well, all it takes is getting on an airplane at 3:30 in the morning. Well, I leave at 3:30 in the morning and get on the airplane at 6 o'clock and then fly there, Mexico City. Fly them from Mexico City to Havana, get off at 10:30 at night, go get some sleep, get up the next morning and go over there. Yeah. That's how it takes. Yeah. Now you can sit and think that it takes something else. Well, you could say that it does take something else. You've had to be prepared to move with the Holy Ghost. Look, people, I understand exactly what happens to folks when they go out into a mission field or they go out into a place and they're not prepared of God. to curl up into a fetal position and come home. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And nobody got saved, and no signs and wonders, and no miracles. But what Father wants is wherever we go, God wants to raise up people in this place, that wherever we go, there's a fire, the Holy Ghost lit.
Yes.
Sudeep said, if you would have just come 2 years ago, maybe I wouldn't be leaving this church. Well, I said, well, you invited me 2 years ago, but the Lord didn't allow me to come 2 years ago. I'm here now, right at the time that you're going to leave. Because that's the perfect time. Especially when a person's leaving and not supposed to leave. Isn't that the perfect time to come? But what if I got there just to read a couple of verses of scripture to them? And tell them what it means to me, what it meant to me. What I feel God is saying. No, Papa wants to teach us how to move in authority. Father wants to teach. Come, Moshiki Talamate. Hallelujah. Well, I can't even talk about that yet. You're just gonna have to learn how to obey first. You can't obey the parents in the house. You can't obey God. You can't honor the parents in the house. You're not honoring God. And so you're just going to have to understand. Floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul. Some of you need to repent. There's people in this place that need to repent right now. And if you just do it, you just repent. It's the greatest act of deliverance. What's so hard of repenting? Why is it so hard to repent? It should be easy to repent. Father, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I can't believe I behaved that way. And then I need to be equipped. I need to be helped because Satan is going to try to continue to play his game on me and keep me sorted away from what God has for me. The Antichrist spirit, the demonic realms, what they want to do is they want to shut down the flow of the river. That's all they want to do. They want to shut down the flow of the power of God through your life. They want to shut down the expression of the Holy Ghost through your life. That's all. That's all they're interested in. You can go on being a Christian, but they do not want the display of the anointing in your life. You can go on being a Christian, doing whatever it is you do. But the display, the power, and the glory of God, Satan's going to do whatever he can do to stop that. Now, the difference is whether or not you're going to walk in the anointing, whether you're going to walk in the realms of the Spirit of God. Because if you learn how to walk in the anointing, the realms of the Spirit of God, then there's no way Satan can't do anything. He can try all he wants. He ain't going to do nothing. Hallelujah. I'm going to obey God. I'm going to obey divine rules, divine principles. I'm going to walk in divine authority. Hallelujah. I'm going to hunger and thirst after righteousness. I'm going to understand how to walk in submission. I'm going to learn how to walk in lowliness and meekness. I'm going to understand how to esteem everybody better than myself. I'm going to learn how to bless when I'm cursed. Huh? Hallelujah. It's hard to be blessed when you believe you're cursed. There's people walk around thinking they're cursed. It's hard to be blessed. There's people, somebody said, well, this is the way that my genetics are. My grandfather was this way, my dad was this way, and I'm that way. You've not been redeemed. Or if you have been redeemed, you never really believed or had faith in the power of redemption that erases all that. Oh, I'm still living under the harassment of my fifth grade teacher who beat me in the head with a ruler and made me sit with a dunce hat, and everybody laughed at me, and I've never gotten over it. And any time somebody raises their voice, it all comes back to me. Well, you've never been set free from the powers of torment and the powers of darkness. You're not liberated. But you can get liberated tonight because we got the liberating anointing. I had a woman, not too long ago came to me and said, well, I would really like to come to this church, but when you start hollering, it reminds me of my dad who used to holler at me, and I just get all queasy inside and I can't take it. Well, you just need to be delivered. You got a demonic power.
Yeah.
And it's going to begin with forgiveness. Because you got unforgiveness in your life. I'm going to tell you right now, you're not right with God. Because if you can't forgive, if you've not learned enough of grace to forgive, you're not being forgiven. Yeah. As soon as you forgive, it has no more power over you anymore. I can scream and holler all I want, and it ain't going to cause you to feel queasy.
Yeah.
Are you listening to me? You listen. Oh, all these excuses. Well, I can't respond. You need to be delivered. You need to get set free. And we got the set free anointing right here. But you can hold on to the thing if you want to.
You can hold on to the human realm and be governed by a human realm to where the Holy Ghost is completely set outside of your life. Oh, you can't talk to me like that because my dad used to talk to me like that, or my mom used to talk to me like that, or my school teacher used to talk to me like that, or somebody said that no one was supposed to talk to me like that, or that I'm the king of the world and I'm supposed to be, you know, I'm supposed to get a badge for losing. No, Phil told me the other day, he said that, you know, that Cairo came home and they lost to soccer. They had a pretty good soccer team, but there was a better soccer team and they lost a tournament. But all of them got a trophy. And he says, no, you're not getting that trophy. You don't get the trophy. You lost. When you win, you get the trophy. Everybody gets trophies because we don't want anybody to somehow get some dysfunctional attitude about themselves. Listen, that is completely dysfunctional. That is just totally weird. Everybody gets a medal for being a loser. No. No, you got to get this right. Then you get the medal. You got to run to win. Then you get the medal. Hello. It's not a Western thing. It's a kingdom of God thing. Hallelujah. You do it right, you're going to be able to flow in the Holy Ghost. You do it wrong, you're not. You do it your own way, you're getting nothing. If whatever it is that's causing you some kind of problems and concern is shutting the Holy Ghost out of your life because you're so overwhelmed with your self-interest, you're going to have to learn first and foremost how to deny yourself. Well, first and foremost, God wants to deliver you from that tormenting thing. He wants to bring into your life healing and forgiveness and mercy. And then he wants to shore you up with the ability to deny yourself. Amen. Hallelujah. He wants to shore you up with the ability to be able to submit yourself to God and resist the devil and he flees. Amen. My dad didn't like me. My husband divorced me. My second husband divorced me. I've got a problem with men. We want you to get set free. Because that's a tormenting, harassing demon spirit that's shutting God out. And allowing man to dominate your spirit and to dominate your thinking. You listening to me? I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to clean this house. I'm going to get myself a broom here in a few minutes. I'm telling you, I'm not letting nothing sit there and smile and resist me. Amen. When it needs to be sobbing and crying right now. You're not going to play no patty cake religion with me. You're going to get right. This is too good of news to turn it into bad news. This is too important of an issue to continue on going in your own way. Why should you come all the way to the place of complete redemption and be a prisoner to your sin and be a prisoner to your past? Papa wants to give you brand new genetics. Hallelujah. He wants to create a new creation. Old things pass away and everything else has now become new. Hallelujah. Everything about your life has become new. And everything belongs to God. Amen. Here's the agreement of the covenant. Now, nothing to do with your husband, your dad, your mom, your grandfather, your school teacher, the person who drove the bus, your big brother, the person, the bully down the street, whatever. All of this stuff. That all these people need inner healing from. Jesus, help us. Thank you, Jesus. I command you right now to be innerly healed, inwardly healed, right now. I command you now in Jesus' name to be inwardly healed. Now! Now! In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Now! You got to resist with all that is within you to not get inwardly healed with just that one now. That's a shout from heaven. The Lord opens up John chapter 15 verse 1 for us and tells us really once again how sanctified we are. and more verses 1 and 2. I mean, people talk about sanctification be a process. Sanctification is as much a process as salvation. Sanctification and salvation is much of a process of being born again. No one stuck in the birth canal of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You're born again or you're not. You're sanctified or you're not born again. Because you can't be the temple of God where God dwells in you and not be sanctified. And what process is that? Has the scripture to describe that? Nothing other than to be born again. When you're born again, you made a new creation. You're a temple of God. God comes and dwells and abides on the inside of us. We receive His Holy Spirit, Spirit of holiness. Hallelujah. We become the inner sanctum. I'm telling you right now, every concept of sanctification defined in the Old Testament would give no place or any room whatsoever for it. Any process is today declared in these times where people just simply don't want to just fully give themselves over to the Lord. I want you to fully give yourself over to Jesus. I'm preaching so you'll fully give yourself over to Jesus. You'll quit playing games with God. Quit spending half your time doing whatever it is you do and start doing full time everything that God's doing. Learn how to just take a hold of the Holy Ghost in the morning and walk in Him all day. Yes. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus said, I'm the true vine, my Father's the husband. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, He takes away. It's so important to hear that. Every branch that brings forth fruit, He purges it. Praise God, purge me, Lord. Amen. That it may bring forth more fruit. Hallelujah. I want to say more fruit. Hallelujah. You tonight, you sitting here, you either as a born-again believer, you either in the vine and you a fruitless branch that is going to be taken away, or you a fruitful branch that's going to be purged. Cut back, in other words, pruned by the Father. It's a better word. Hallelujah. You decide tonight who you are. Decide tonight who you are. Obedient to God or disobedient to God. Doing those things which He said to do. Walking in His Word and walking by the Spirit or doing it your own way. Because that's going to make the difference of whether you are a branch without fruit. I mean, because it's going to come to a time. It comes to a time where the Lord says enough is enough. And He comes to the fig tree even in the time when it's not the season for figs. And said, you don't have anything. I've come to you now even when you're not ready. And I curse it in Jesus' name. It's ultimately where the minister stands. Because he showed us a model of what we're supposed to do. Henceforth, no man shall eat fruit from you forever. This is what Jesus is talking. It literally, the application to a nation. The application to individuals. He does. He said, I tried your works and I found them. They're not perfect. Repent before I come and fight against you with the sword of my mouth. People don't believe in a Jesus like this. They don't believe in the Jesus of the Bible. They believe in a humanized Jesus, a secular humanized Jesus, a children's storybook Jesus that was written by a demon. Yeah. It's about time, people, we get into the fear of the Lord. We get into the reality of what God demands and recognize that our only appropriate response to His love is obedience. I hope you more perfectly understand what I mean by our only right response to His love is obedience. Now, more than you did when I began this meeting tonight. Jesus says, without me, He's going to say by verse 5, without me you can do nothing. And it's about time you people understand that you've been doing a lot of stuff by yourself. And you're just going to have to stop it. You're going to have to get on your face before God. You're going to have to touch heaven until you know how to move in the things of heaven. Well, you know how to make God first. You know how to put Father in a place where you honor Him. And you give Him your best, not your leftovers.
Yes. Yes.
And if it takes you, if you've got to start at 1 o'clock in the morning getting ready for church to make it on time at 7 p.m., you get up at 1 a.m. and start.
Yes.
Pretty crazy. You didn't figure you'd live in San Francisco, but whatever it takes. Start honoring God. Because this is what Father demands. If you're going to be in this church, you're going to honor God. You're going to obey God. You're going to obey me. You're going to do what's right.
Yeah.
And if I don't like what you're doing, I'm going to tell you. And if you don't like it, you need to leave. Because we're going to make room for the power of God to come in this place.
Yeah.
I'm going to make room. I'm not dealing with it no more. I'm done. I'm going to start acting like I'm in a third world country now.
I'm going to start moving. I'm not going to make transition anymore coming back from overseas. I'm going to do it just like I do it over there, here. Get rid of your arrogant attitude, your Western attitude. Huh? Your Western know-it-all, I got an A attitude. Huh? Come on over into the kingdom of God. Get yourself submitted to the authorities. Get yourself submitted to the power of the Holy Ghost. We want you to learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. We want you to learn how. We want you to be taught of God how to be servant of all, because that's what He's looking for. That's what you need to be the slave to everyone. We want to take you to a training on how to be slave to everyone. How to sort you out quick. Huh? Hallelujah. I need to call people up and tell them to come over and change my light bulbs. Just sort you out to see how much a slave you are. You become slave to all. It's going to shut down the strife, the envy, the division, the seditions, huh? The jealousies, huh? It's going to shut it down. It will shut it down. It will shut it down. You're not willing to do this, it's going to be constantly ruling you and dominating you. It's a big, gigantic, demonic claw sitting right about mid-center of your head, pulling you around while you sing psalms of praise. Ain't going to be. Ain't going to be. Papa's put a fiery word in my mouth to see revival come, the United States of America. Father's put a fiery word in my mouth to see this church sorted out. I'm going to begin right here, and I'm going to tell you right now, I know that if the fire of God fell in this place right now, in this kind of a way, to begin to say you, to call you out, say you, address you right now. Here's what's going on in your life. Are you willing to repent? The majority of you, the people that are in this place, you would repent, and you would get it right, and you'll make the cut. There's a few of you still running. You're still running and hiding, and you know who you are. You know who you are. And it ain't going to be long. Everybody else going to know who you are, because I'm going to bring you up front and parade you around. It's true. It is true. So you have a space of time to repent before I bring you up and parade you around. You have a space of time to get it right. What you going to do? Because I'm serious. I'm not playing ha-ha joke. The stakes are too high. Right. Yeah. What Father wants to do in the midst of this church right now, He demands everything to be right and everything to be in order. He demands it. He demands it. He ain't going to move over top of the problem. Not the way He wants to move. Not when it's like the result of it is millions of people coming into the kingdom. I could say, wouldn't it be amazing if all of a sudden you stepped over into a place of interaction with God where you were overwhelmed with joy unspeakable, full of glory, walking in an effulgency of the flow of heaven through your life that was an unceasing display of His power and glory. I'm telling you, that's what He wants. That's what He labors to bring to pass. That's it. There's a sovereign movings of God, and I'm getting myself ready. And I'm getting this church ready. And we love you, but you know what? We don't love you as much as we love Him. Love Him a whole lot more. Love the move of God a whole lot more. So, Father, we thank You for doing this. Father, I don't have the wisdom to know how to break a couple of these people out of the stronghold that has been in their life for years. But Lord, You do. Yes. Thank You, Lord.
And Lord, we know that you do not want to leave anyone out. But you demand change.
Yes, Lord.
Going on with the same bad attitudes, the same behavior, the same rut, the same spiritual condition, the same sick and diseased state, spiritually and physically, just isn't going to work anymore. So, Lord, we just thank you that you shine the floodlight of heaven upon our soul and that you do whatever you've got to do in order for you to bring forth the display of your power and your glory on the scale that you demand that you want. In Jesus' name. Good. I'm so glad that you agreeing with me. Because Father hears it and he sees it. He's watching every response to what's going on right now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus says in verse 3, you're clean to the word which is spoken unto you. And he says, and here's the contract. Here's the commitment. Here's the commitment. He's telling us, he says, dwell in me. And people, I want you to understand, we have a display of who he is and what it is he looks like, which then addresses every one of our attitudes, every one of our disposition, the demeanor of our face, our posture, our behavior. Listen, you can't walk around all depressed, dysfunctional, and as an introvert and tell me you walk in the Holy Ghost. Because he's none of the above.
Amen.
Or I should say, he's none of the beneath. I'm going to just tell you people, God wants you to hate your life in this world.
Yeah.
Your behavior and your attitude, your disposition, your character that you so admire because that's what was your mama and your grandmama and your great-grandmama and your great-great-grandmama. Look, we want to end your mama.
Yeah.
We want to begin Jesus. We have no regards for any man's person. God's given us the privilege to live his life. We're hungry and thirsty to get you over into the glory realm. Quit living your own life. Look at what Father has for you. Woo! Man, I tell you right now, if my voice wasn't so gone, I'd be shouting and screaming right now. Hallelujah. Because it's real. It's real. This is real. This is real. I get to live in life. Hallelujah.
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 Ruthie Ann has done a good job. You guys have hooked in, man. I'm telling you, this you're being the church I've always wanted to be a part of. I'm stoked. Hallelujah. Jesus says, abide in me. I mean, don't redefine it. He's defined it. Don't redefine it. Don't just make it something that it is not. The Lord says in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, if you say you abide in him, you are to walk even as he walked. I mean, that defines it. I mean, of course, John breaks it down even with greater detail of what it means to abide in him, what it means to dwell in him, and it would be good for you to go and just memorize the first epistle of John so you can see it, you don't dilute it, you don't make it something different than it is, because if you look at it for what it is he's asked us to be, and then you become real about it and you want it more than anything else, you're going to have it because God the Holy Ghost has dedicated himself to bringing it to pass in our life. Hallelujah. And it don't take 50 years. Praise God. Got to go find a church where everybody's old and gray and withered up. Man, there you can find a move of God. No, it happens instantaneously. Praise God. It don't take long to get people moving in these things if we can get all the influencers out of their life. And it's just not demon power that's influencing them contrary to the Word of God. It's a bunch of people around them have no sense at all when it comes to the Word of God and the Spirit of God. Speaking lies. stealing the counsel of the Lord with words without knowledge, their own ideas, their own perception, their own thinking, what they feel is right to do. No, none of us know what's right to do. God has given to us exactly what we're supposed to do and told us what is right. He alone holds what is right. He alone is right, which is a synonym for truth. He alone is truth. His word alone is truth. God demands our complete conformity.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Anything but his word is a lie. We're going to bow our knee to his word or not.
Amen.
You want to make it up. Making it up. Self-justifying, saving iniquity. Stopping the flow of God. Hindering the move of the Holy Ghost. No. Turn yourself over to God. Quit self-justifying. Jesus, the terms of the contract is you come dwell in me. You come dwell in me and I in you. Just think about it, people, because that's a supernatural thing. That is every bit of that, every bit of that. Every bit right here, verse 4, is supernatural. It takes a miracle. It's a miraculous thing. That's going to take hunger and thirsting, that takes yieldedness and brokenness, that takes willingness to obey God, to obey His spiritual laws, to say, yes, Father, my life is no longer my own. It is yours. I'm bought with a price. I am the temple of the living God. You own me. I'm here to learn how to be a servant, to have a good attitude, to rejoice in you, to do what you commanded me to do, to walk around and do those things, O Lord, that you yourself did. That's what it means to abide in Him. Quit playing pretend. Oh, come on, Ruth Anna. Hallelujah. I'm not going to babysit your mediocrity. Patty cake, play patty cake with your demons or dance to your tune. Come on. That is a quotable quote. Praise God. Somebody's got the anointing to speak the word of the Lord. Instead of sit around doing their own thing, playing some religious game, holding on to their own opinions. People, every day, our opinions should be being completely sold out and conformed to the Word of God. Our ideas should be completely molded by the Spirit of the Lord that looks just like what God said in His Word, which lives and abides forever. Everything else will perish. From Genesis, from Matthew 7, 21. To 1 John 2:16, they that do to the will of the Lord shall abide forever. Everything else is passing away. Everybody who's involved in it, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, all that is in the world, every bit of it passes away. But they that do the will of the Lord abide forever. They that do the will of the Father abides forever. Many were saying that day, we've done this, we've done that, we've done the other thing. And he said, "I depart from me, ye worker of iniquity. I never knew you. You never did the will of the Father. You did your own will. You walked your own walk. Oh, your mother and your brother and your sisters are without desiring to see you." He says, "Who is my mother? Who is my brother? Who is my sister? Who is my family? But they that do the will of my Father." I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to make sure that I'm right in the middle of being His kinsman, of being His family. There is proof to it. He showed us the servitude. He showed us the disposition. And if you don't measure up, you repent and you get it right. And you come under the rule. And you quit living at your own life. And you quit living it your own way. And you learn how to be a slave to God. And a slave to His ministry. And a slave to His things. And a slave to the Holy Ghost. Because what a life. That's the abundant life. Because you're going to be a slave to something. You'll be a slave to your depression, a slave to your sickness, a slave to your sorrow, a slave to your sin, a slave to your iniquity. You listening to me? God wants to break the yoke. God Himself wants to break the yoke. God will break the yoke right now. God has purpose to break the yoke right now. Hallelujah. I'm getting ready to make an altar call here in just a few moments. And I know the Father's dealing with people's hearts. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is here to strip off, to break off. His word is powerful. It's living. It's like a sharp two-edged sword that pierces into the heart to divide soul from spirit, joint from marrow.
God brings a miraculous change to everyone who desires, everyone who's willing, and takes us from a realm of being in the demonic and takes us over into the realms of being a part of the family of God in oneness with the Master, in oneness with the Father, in oneness with the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, abide in me and I in you. This is the covenant deal. It's the covenant. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in me, no more can you except you abide in me. Dear people, I'm going to help you understand right now. This is the dimension of whether or not you're going to flow and operate in the Holy Ghost, walk in the Spirit, be filled with the Spirit, be moved with divine love and compassion, having the flow of His peace and having the flow of His joy and having the flow of heaven. This is what's going to make the difference right here of whether you're dwelling in Him. You dwell in Him, you give yourself to dwelling in Him, you're going to have the fruit that He alone produces. You're going to have the love, the compassion that He alone produces. You're going to have the supernatural grace and presence and divine communion. People want religion. I'm telling you here, I'm here to break off religion. I'm here to break off everything that is not conformity to God's word and His way. Because anything that's not conformity to His word and His way is a place of agreement with the demonic. Hallelujah. Sipata rabo kuste beretesti. Me brede sipata kurita pa. Mambredeshi. Father, I thank you. I call down the fire, God. I call down the fire, God, upon you. I call down the fire of God upon your life. I call down the fire on you. Hallelujah. There's not a person in this place tonight. It's impossible for you to remain the same. It's impossible for you to remain the same. It's impossible for you to remain the same. Tonight, God demands things become right. The Lord says, if you don't abide in me, the consequence is that you're cast forth from the vine. People say, oh, once you're saved, you're always saved. Not according to that. They were saved. They were in the vine. You cast forth from the vine. Why? Because you didn't bear forth fruit. What fruit? The fruit of His life. The fruit of His life. The fruit of His ways. The fruit of His doings. Huh. Father searches the hearts of men. He sees, He looks right now and He sees who it is that wants to live His life and walk the way He walks. He sees. He sees the response and the attitude of our hearts at noonday, in the evening, in the morning. He sees, He looks, He tries the sons of men. I'm telling you, when Father looks and He sees in the heart of a person that they want to do it just like Jesus, they want to live just like Jesus, they want to live the life that God has purchased for us at Calvary's cross, that Christ Jesus raised up from the dead for us to have, He then mobilized all heaven to bring it to pass. He's filled us with everything that we have need of according to His divine power. He has done a work. He's given us all things that pertain to His life and His godliness. It's time to hear it. It's time to stop making excuses for yourself. Yes, it's time to abhor your own way. Yes, and cleave unto the Lord. Yes. Lay hold on eternal life, as Paul said. He said, if we neglect so great a salvation, we shall surely perish. You can't stagger between two opinions. You can't live double-minded about this. You can't live your own life and live the life of God at the same time. You can't live for money, for jobs, for personal interest, and live for God at the same time. Our whole life is to be centered around heaven right now, as much as it would be if we, when we pass from this life into the next. People want to make it like somehow we're supposed to center our life around our own purposes, around job, around our own pleasure.
Somehow, the model that man has set before us of responsibility is God's way. I tell you it's not. He's called us to live our life seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Living out a life where we're seeking after those things that belong to the Father and living out those things which He's commissioned us to do. Centered to the church, centered to a witness of this wonderful life that God has given, understanding that men right now are held in the darkness of sin and held in the darkness of the blindness of demonic power, and the only hope is a bright and great shining church filled with the life of Jesus Christ. A great and blinding light, hallelujah, of the church. If we don't give ourselves, if our life is not about reaching the lost, our life is meaningless. If our life isn't about heaven and bringing people into the kingdom of God, it's meaningless. If our life is about having some kind of a house and money and a vocation and a vacation, we're living for our own interest. You cannot serve God in your own interest. You cannot serve God in your own will. Same as you can't serve God in mammon. We better make the central theme of the ministry and life of Jesus our central theme. Otherwise, we're not dwelling in Him. We're not abiding in Him. We're not walking as He walked. Give me a break. Dear people, I want you to understand, there are many of you who go to work and you're working jobs right now, and the finances that you've been able to sow into the kingdom in here, in this ministry, has made a huge difference. It's been a big part of how we were able to go do things that we've gone and done over the past 4 weeks that nobody else is doing. It's not redundant. The impact of it was heavenly. There was no one else to do it. It wasn't something that could have just been left. But at the same time, you're going to have to understand, if ministry that has, Father has for you right now, is ministry that has to do with jobs, still, you have to have central to that His purposes in your life, the lost and dying world. Not only in the way that you sent me to go into the nations, not only in the way that you participate in other things in terms of reaching the lost, because we're able to sow into the ministry of remnant, of Pat and Karen Schatz line, of Back to Jerusalem, and so many others, Tim Hall, and all the things that those ministries are doing as well. But it's not about you living your life for a job. It's about you living your life out in the kingdom. It's about you. It's not about you just giving your money and doing it with your money vicariously. No. That's just an expansion of who you are and what you're doing. It's about you living in His life. You living and walking in the realms of the Spirit. You living and walking in the realms of the display of the power of God through your life. Because you're not willing to be silent. You're not willing to do it by your own power and your own might. You're not willing to give yourself to your own time and your own interest. You only want those things that the Spirit of the living God can produce. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Just going ahead and read this. Here is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. Where I'm asking, Father, we're asking, Father, tonight. I mean, I'm just, listen. I am blessed by what's happening here in the church. God demands everything to be in order, perfectly in order. He said, I tried your works and I found them, but they're not perfect. And then they got to be perfect. For Him to be able to produce what He wants to produce, just go and read His address to the churches, because every one of them have a testimony to us today. Not just one, not just the church of Laodicea, and every one of them have a testimony to us today of places where we can very clearly see the order of the church and what He demands and what He wants, because He's waiting to produce something in us. He's waiting to bring forth something in us. You can look in the history books of revival, and you can see where there's churches over the generations that have been willing to fully cooperate with him and what he did through them. They were willing to fully cooperate with everything that they knew about him, and especially the disposition of lowliness and meekness and submission and obedience and not allowing strife and division and envy. Oh, kotarabastikia, and evil speakings. Guile. Talking bad about people. His anger burns with a fury against it. I'm telling you, his anger burns with a fiery fury against evil speaking. Just we want none of it. We just want to give ourselves to the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Your life needs centered around the will of the Father. And the things that you do need to be about dwelling in him, and him dwelling in you. You need to follow the leadership Father has given you. Not some preacher down, you know, 10 blocks away, or on television, or in another state, or in another country. Yeah. You want to imitate them, go join the church.
Yeah.
Pack up, move, go over there. Hope that works out for you. Because I'm telling you, I have looked around, and I've viewed things. And I'm very happy with the passionate pursuit of the Holy Ghost that exists in this church. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I want to reap the full benefits of that pursuit.
Yes.
And I know you do too.
Yes.
I have no doubt about it.
Yes.
That some of you don't understand that some of your behavior, okay, it qualifies for 6-month-old and it needs to be corrected. And it needs to be changed and stopped. Hallelujah. And I'm up for the occasion. Hallelujah. I'm going to just help you get rid of the stuff that you want out of your life. So don't fight me while I'm helping you get rid of the stuff that you want out of your life. Even if you don't know it.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I said, all you got to do is just cry out and say, Lord, bend me. From your heart, you just begin to, you just, Lord, I don't want anything in my life that is not pleasing unto you. I don't want any behavior. I don't want any attitudes in my life. I don't want to live under any kind of fear. I don't want to live under any kind of torment. I don't want to live under any kind of behavior that is contrary to the realms of the Holy Ghost. The deal is, I'm dwelling in you. Dear people, understand, God has empowered us to do that. By simply the willingness to say, I'm in you, I'm dwelling in you. I pray every one of you wake up every morning with that song going off in your head. God is holy and he made me holy. And that you don't stop short of, I'm in him and he's in me. I'm in him and he's commanded me. And you understand what it is. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And that you let God touch you with an excessive joy. Hallelujah. And you let God touch you. You let him touch you with an abundant life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Haraba kostiti alala masepatera. Tikane moshita. Tikana moshita robotai. Haribosheinda balikata. Hallelujah. Now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we come out against sickness and disease. Every tormenting thing, every harassing thing, every afflicting power of darkness. You know, those of you who have given yourself at times in the past to things that belong to the demonic, right now in the name of Jesus Christ, we take authority over that realm of the satanic and the confusion, the spiritual confusion that Satan is able to work against you so that you allow it back in. Now in the name of Jesus, so that you begin to understand that overcomer's lifestyle, that more than a conqueror's lifestyle, that victorious living in Jesus Christ. Because I'm going to tell you right now, those demonic powers which come at you, it's just like a disease. It's just like a disease, and just like a disease, it can be broken. And it is broken right now in the name of Jesus. And you just will it. You will it. You will it. You will it. And I'm telling you right now, the more you drink of the pleasures of His presence, look. You want to stay, you want to get, if you've got sickness in your body, I'll tell you how to get rid of the sickness and disease. Start flowing in the anointing. It'll go. It will go. I don't care what it is, it will go. You stay with it. You want to make sure no sickness or disease comes back in your body? Flow in the anointing. You can't tell me that the life-giving power of God can be flowing through your body, the same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, and you still remain sick and diseased. No. Get rid of your attitudes that are contrary to the way of God. Because all the sickness is a reflection of your of some spiritual disease. It is. You deal with it for what it is and quit self-justifying, trying to, you know, pacify your little self because you're just too weak to deal with the truth. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
God emboldened you to just stand in the light. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let the light, floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul and say, okay, God, I want everything out of my life. It's not supposed to be in my life. Because you could do exactly what I said and not have one bit of condemnation about it. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, He's making me feel condemned because, you know, I got a sickness, and now He's telling me it's because it's of a spiritual sickness, and I just feel terrible. I just don't know if I'm right with God. Well, you're an idiot. All has been exposed is your idiocy. Now you can see, you know. Father's purpose that we grow and that we mature and that we, every part of our life becomes conformed to Him. And if He can't show us, because we're basically, you know, on the bubble, we're about to fall off the ledge, if we have any possibility that there's something wrong with us, it will bring into question whether or not He loves us and whether or not we're right. Come on, give me a break. Let God mold you, change you, fashion you, shape you, mature you, grow you, develop you, sort you out, get things right. Hallelujah. And the whole time, not be in any kind of condemnation because you're a child of God. Hallelujah. Not feel like, oh no, He doesn't love me. I got a problem. He's made me feel like I'm not right with God. Come on. Right with God. You just need to grow up. You need to get right. Things need to be conformed to Him, His image, His ways of doing things. Halaborasaya. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let your hands up. Harasatala. Harabosikishte. Haraboshikiteshte. Command your body right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Let your hands cave. We speak strength and healing to Ruth Anna's body right now in Jesus' name. Right now in the name of Jesus. You're going to have such, continue to have such a hard time having a baby.
Oh God, I think you made me a man.
In the name of Jesus. Kitarabakashi talalala shapa. Go. Foul spirit of hell attacking that body, Ruthanna. Thank you, Father, for the anointing that breaks off the yoke. Hallelujah. Sheeparungadanea. Hallelujah. Rustifrana namandalea. Halabumbradesifidalanomanea. And don't listen to the doctors. Listen to the come under their fear ideas. Okay? Their fear threats. We in too deep for them to help. Are you with me? We in too deep for man to help. I'll tell you right now. God and God alone. What are you going to do? We in deep. Hallelujah. Can't stagger between two opinions. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Karabasha pakaya lahasateya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I'm getting ready to lay hands on everybody in the place, but before I do, Sunday morning and Sunday night, we're so honored to have one of the leading ministers of the House Church of China here. I don't know that he's ever ministered in the United States of America. As far as I know, he's never ministered in the United States of America. His great-grandfather was a medical doctor and a pastor, was led through the streets right at the time of the Cultural Revolution, Mao Zedong's reign of terror, until he died of exhaustion. They put a big old dunce hat on him and led him through the streets, you know, declaring how, you know, he believed in Jesus and how stupid he was for doing so, and what a, you know, terrible example he is to the People's Republic of China, yada, 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 until he died of exhaustion. That family's a champion. I mean, they go to the university, they preach Jesus publicly. The day before Ann and I got there, when we were ministering at their place, their whole house was raided, they were hauled off to jail. But, you know, they always get out. They're just bold. They're just, kill me, get it over with, whatever. But I'm not going to stop talking about Jesus. We're not going to stop reaching the lost. We're not going to stop declaring the things of the kingdom. That's just who they are. Radical. Hallelujah. And the family took me out when we were in Zibwa in the Jinan province of China. And they were showing me this big, gigantic soccer field. And they said, this is where we want you to do an open-air crusade. I'm like, now? They said, let's do it. And this is how bold they are. They're just bold. We're supposed to be with them. We're supposed to be with them later on this year. I don't know how we're going to work that out, but somehow it's going to work out. We're going to let Father do it. The work is plenteous. Listen, it's time the many do the work of the few. And I just want to send people to go. Okay? I don't want to just have to pick and choose from my family and a couple of people in the front row. I'm looking for everybody. Okay? And I'm not going to have you go and embarrass the kingdom of God with some little, you know, blip of a power of God demonstration. And then you're sick at the next meeting. Because you'll be sick. You'll be sick every meeting. You get out there and you're making any headway in the kingdom of God. If Satan can put sickness on you, you'll be basically hauled back in an intensive care unit to America. They'll jet stream you back in an intensive care unit. I'm not kidding you. I'm not kidding you. You need to go do some little mission trip and paint somebody's house, you'll be just fine. But I'm talking about breaking the yokes, bringing the fire of God, signs and wonders and miracles. Hallelujah. Seeing people change. Seeing lives change. That's tearing down the kingdom of darkness. Hallelujah. Lighting the fire of heaven upon people's souls. Hallelujah. When we
We purpose that everybody in this place will do that. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Thank you,
Lord Jesus. Kikarababasi karabata. Li di bruna sheo. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, everybody stand. Everybody stand. Come up here. Come on up here. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to lay hands on you. Power of God comes on you. Listen, I tell you, one of the hardest things to learn is to quit doing things your own way and following wrong examples and wrong models.
Yes.
It's the hardest thing. Because people are so, they're born arrogant. They're born with pride of life all over them. And then they give their life to Jesus and they don't even know how to deal with that. Because it's much more subtle than the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. And the only way you can possibly deal with it is that you understand, just simply give yourself over to lowliness and meekness, learn how to be a servant of all, just hallelujah. Praise God. Follow Jesus. I'm not asking anyone to follow me. You follow me as I follow Jesus. I'm asking you to follow Jesus. I'm following Jesus.
Amen.
I'm passionately pursuing His life, His ministry, His way, His demeanor, His stuff. And you know, it's so easy. Father has made it so easy. You know why? You know how He has made it so easy? He's made it all about love. Just loving Him.
Yes.
Just being so happy with Him.
Yes.
He's made it about us trusting Him in the dimensions of that love. And understanding, once again, that the proper response to love is obedience.
Yes.
And you know, the things that He asks us to do. Most of what God asks us to do in terms of obedience is how we love one another. How we serve one another. So it's a real pretty circular thing, you know what I'm saying? He pours His love in us so that we can love one another. Hallelujah. Praise Him. He pours His, you know, He comes with to us with His love. He says, I want you to obey me. Okay, what do you want me to do? I want you to love everybody. I want you to love everybody on the scale of serving them. And I'm going to supply my anointing. I'm going to supply my divine ability for you to do it.
Yes.
And I want to pour my compassion through you so that everybody that is a prisoner of the satanic world, the demonic realm, comes to realize how much I love them through you.
Amen.
Yes.
Then He's chosen that the preaching of the gospel by the power of the Holy Ghost through signs and wonders and demonstration of the power of God is the only way that it is done. Not by your hands in your pocket and your spiel. Well, this is what I think you ought to do. You go to church anywhere? I mean, some of the things that Pentecostal people do, and I'm like, goodness gracious. Start over. Cut. Producer, cut. A flow of the Holy Ghost. A flow of the Holy Ghost that is a gushing forth through you. Listen, a gushing forth through you with the very life of God. Easy, because He's commanding you and I to dwell in Him. In other words, a synonym phrase for dwelling in Him is living His life. He's commanding us. He says in this way, live my life. He says, live my life. And I'll live in you. That's what He says. Live my life and I'll live in you. That's the proper way of translating abide in me and I'll abide and I in you. I in you. Live my life and I'll live in you. It's a command. I'm in Him and He's commanded me to be. Hey, live my life. Live my life. Live my life. Live my life. It's an expensive you living your life. You lose your life and you'll find it. What? How will you find it? You'll find it in Him, His life. It's your life or His life. This is what you choose. It's not some dual nature. You somewhere stuck between the devil's life and God's life. What a scenario. What a cop out. It's a choice. His life or your life.
And Father searches our heart. He's searching our heart right now. He knows. He knows whether we're desperate about living His life or whether we're still holding on our own life because we want to get this and we want to get that and we want to do this and we want to do that and we got to have that. Jesus. We got to feel better about ourselves because I don't feel small. I feel small, not big. You need to feel small in yourself. He'll make you feel big enough in Him. Where's joy unspeakable? Full of glory. Living His life. Where's peace that passes understanding? Living His life. Where's love that goes beyond all knowledge? Living His life. Where's life forevermore? Living His life. Where's the abundant life? Living His life. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But not I. Christ. I'm living His life. And it's far better than living a life of pornography. It's far better than living a life of lust. It's far better than living a life of hate. It's far better than living a life of envy and self-pursuit. Far better than living a life of ungodliness. Come on, give me a break. Satan has created a premium on the demonic life. And people just feel like, I just can't live without it. What a lie! What a lie! It's about time there's some light that shines. If there's some witness that shows, no, here it is. I prayed that you get violent. I prayed that the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him strikes your heart tonight. That the religious games come to an end. That the falsehoods come to an end. That Satan doesn't have a chance. You know, Jesus said, Satan comes and he has nothing in me. But when I'm living his life, Satan comes and he has nothing in me. In other words, he comes with his temptation. He comes with his draw. He comes with his pull. You got to have this. Oh, you got to have this lust of the flesh. Oh, you got to have this lust of the eye. Oh, you got to have this pride of life. Oh, you got to have this realm of the demonic. And you're like, what? You stinking loser. Father's going to raise up in this place and in every place. And I pray every one of you, my passion is for every one of you, valiant men. And valiant women. Who are valiant to do good. Who are valiant to do it His way. Who've drawn a bloodline between themselves and the world. And they will not cross over. They will not cross over. They will not cross over. Don't tell me that you're weak and you can't do it. Listen. It's irrelevant. Father's called you to come over, to be transformed. He'll fill you with the strength of His power. He'll give you a new desire. Gives you a new desire. You will not be willing to justify wrongdoing of any sort. You'll not be willing to justify anything that doesn't look like God. If it doesn't look like God, you identify, that doesn't look like God, and I don't want it. Has no right in my life, whether it's sin, sickness, or disease. And you'll lay hold on faith. You'll lay hold on the things of heaven till the change comes. Hallelujah. Why? Why? Because you believe that God is and that He's here and that He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Because you believe that you call and He answers. Because you believe that He's right here. He's God of heaven and of earth. He has absolute authority. And if you seek Him, He's going to do what? He's going to answer you. He's going to establish you. But He's not going to mix it up with falsehood. He's not going to be in the middle of hanky-panky with the world. He's not going to be in the middle of it. He's not going to be in the middle of
A double-mindedness, some for the world, some for you, God, some for me, some for you, God. No, he's not going to do it. He's going to, no. His mercy is going to be there. His love is going to say, no, I'm not doing it. I'm not playing a game. You get real. God, if God, who is the Spirit of Truth, God the Holy Ghost, who is the Spirit of Truth, was to agree with our lie, he would no longer be the Spirit of Truth. Because truth has no lie in it. He's waiting for us to get real. And I believe with all of my heart, and I see and I know that the majority of you, if not all of you, are just real with God in this place. And you've turned your back on the world to follow Jesus. And you said, Lord, I don't want anything. I don't want anything but you. I recognize that this life is very short and it's all about heaven. It's all about the lost being reached. It's all about your life being lived. It's not about anything else. It's not about my job. It's not about, you're not going to be impressed with how much money I have in the bank when I retire, whether I got a house or what my car looks like, or how well I'm dressed. It's not the requirements to enter the kingdom of God. To do the will of the Father. To do the will of the Father. People, if there's anything that we've got to go after, we have to go after a realm of Holy Ghost conviction, the display of the power of God that breaks off the religious blinders and the strongholds that oppress the mind of God's people. I figure that's objective one in revival. And that's not going to happen until each person themselves are willing to fully give themselves over to Holy Ghost conviction and the flow of the Holy Ghost in their own life personally. Because you can never communicate that which you do not have. You can never have going on in your life to where that it impacts others around you, you know, something that you're not yielded to. If you have it tonight, if you're having a problem with authority and being submission to authority, you need to repent. It's a demonic stronghold, and we want to break it. And I know it's here in the house because I've gotten a bit violent with it tonight a couple of times. If you deal with condemnation, I'm not good enough mentality. Let me just tell you right now. Let me tell you the source of it. The pride of life is the source of that. Seemingly counterintuitive. It's the pride of life is the source of it. You need to repent of it. Don't blame it on somebody else. Don't make it somebody else's fault. It's yours. You're not living somebody else's life. Hello, you're living your own life, believe it or not. Nobody else has the power to run your life. Father's given you a will. He didn't put your will in somebody else's body. Amen. And the goodness of God is here leading us to repentance. If there's anything you want to break off of you tonight, is not being under authority. Because I'm just telling you right now, it's the life of the rebel. You can say, well, you can say whatever you want to say about it. God's word is plain on it. Just sensible recognition of deeds and behavior is proof enough. And it's not about shaming anybody. It's about bringing you to a place of repentance. Yeah. Why? So the glory of heaven can flow into your life without hindrance. So that you can live his life. So that you can understand what it means to live free from sin. What it means to live in the glorious liberty of the sons of God. What it means to be able to step right over so easily into the realms of the heavenly.
to live the life of the overcomer. Jesus said, if you overcome as I overcame, then you shall sit down with me in my throne, even as I sat down with my Father in his throne. Be certain of this. If you do not overcome as he overcame, you will not sit down with him in his throne. Paul said, as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. Be certain of this. As many as are not led by the Spirit, they are not the sons of God. Be certain of that. Jesus said, if you dwell in me, you will produce this fruit. If you live my life, you will produce the fruit that Father has purposed. The fruit and the manifestation of the power of God, the Holy Ghost, the flow of the anointing, the flow of heaven, the interaction with the glory that Father alone possesses. Hallelujah. See, Jesus said, it's Father that does the works in me. He said, if you don't believe me for my works, my word, if you don't believe my word, just believe for the works that I do. For it's the Father that does it. And then he goes on to say, that's verse 11 of John 14. Then he goes on to say, anyone who believes, Father will work in them too. That's really what he's saying. Father will work in them too with these works and with greater works than these. But it's in a place of, can you hear me?
Yes.
It's a place of complete surrender and submission to the Father. And that's not hard, and that's not something that you have to have this long process to go through to do. It's something that you and I are simply willing to submit ourselves to do, to have. And then in that submission, with every crossroads of decision, we just obey God. We walk in the Spirit. We say, Holy Ghost, where's the turn? The Word of God showing us. Bless when you're cursed. Bless when you're persecuted. Love your enemies. I mean, real basic stuff. Be in submission to authorities. Learn of me. Come and learn of me. I'm lowly and meek. Come learn of me. Come learn how to walk in lowliness and meekness. Come give all diligence to making your election and calling sure. Add to your faith purity. Add to your purity knowledge. Add to your knowledge self-control. Add to self-control brotherly kindness and godliness and love. This whole realm of yieldiness, walking in humility and walking in meekness.
Yes.
Giving all attendance, giving just focused on it. Lord, this is what I want. I want to be this. I want walking joyfully, walking in a display of being those who are witnesses of who you are, witnesses of a new life. Are you a witness? Do you give yourself to being a witness of a new life? Or do you look like that you under the burden of every circumstance that everybody else is under on Monday morning or Thursday morning? I pray tomorrow Thanksgiving. I pray tomorrow to you it will be Thanksgiving Thursday. I will be getting up at 3:30 in the morning and it will be Thanksgiving Thursday, and I hope it's not a quarter after 12. What's wrong with your clock, man? Okay. I see. It's okay if it is. It will be Thanksgiving Thursday. And you know what I will do? I'll say, Holy Spirit, submit myself to you. Reveal the life of Jesus in me. The anointing is nothing more than the life and power of Jesus being revealed in us. We've received an anointing, and this anointing that we've received of him teaches us to live his life, to dwell in him. That's what Scripture says. That's 1 John 1:26. 1 John 1:26. The anointing that we received of him teaches us to live out his life. The anointing is the life and power of Jesus revealed in us. That's what Father demands. So we just get to do it. Put your hands towards heaven. Wind of heaven. Wind of heaven.
Wind of heaven! 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 Blow! Wind of heaven! Wind of heaven! Musaprataya! Wind of heaven! Mama Sashaya! Wind! Wind! Wind of heaven! Mama Dadaya! Wind of heaven! Santariello! Wind! Wind of heaven! Wind of heaven! Rabash! Wind! Wind of heaven! Wind! Wind! Wind of heaven blow! Wind! Wind of heaven! Masantaria Baba Sapa Bayalo! Wind of heaven! Manande Rish! Robo Sotaria Mahan! Wind! Mandao Subabana Day! Wind! Wind of heaven! Mamoshipea! Wind of heaven! Mamrababashi! Wind! Wind of heaven! Masapaya! Wind! Wind of heaven! Wind of heaven! Wind of heaven! Blow! Wind! Wind of heaven! Masoto robo shike rimahaya! Wind! Wind of heaven! Blow! Wind! Robo sitaripa! Wind! Aripo sutari! Wind! Wind of heaven blow. Wind of heaven. Masatia rabor city. Wind of heaven. Mamane. Wind of heaven blow. Brasateria bafros. Wind of heaven. Zereba ribasa. Wind. Mamanderext. Wind of heaven! Wind of heaven! Wind, Manjefrost! Wind of heaven! Mamanda Day! Wind, Rasatare Hapaya! Wind of heaven, blow! Wind! Wind of heaven! Wind! Wind of heaven blow! Wind! Brasa pranerest! Wind! Wind! Wind of heaven blow! Wind! Wind, brasatakia ramohos. Wind of heaven, marasatayami. Wind. 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 Wow! Barabasitia. Wind. Wind of heaven. Wind of heaven blow. Wind. Wind. Rusatai. Wind. Wind of heaven. Wind. Wind of heaven. Wind of heaven blow. Wind, Masataya. Wind of heaven. Satatarabosapa. Saprapatosis. Wind. Wind. Masapratain. Wind. Wind. Wind.
Yes, Lord.
Wind of heaven.
Come on, Satan.
Walk in it. He gives strength. Then all we need to do is yield to it. He gives direction. Then all we need to do is obey. He gives it. Dear people, when we lay hands on you and pray for you, you don't need to go begging God. Start trying to get all spiritual. His Father gives. All you have to do is receive. Too many times our response is to do what we think is right. What Father thinks is right is thanksgiving. What Father thinks is right is receptivity. No amount of praying and crying out is going to make a difference with respect to what yieldedness can do. Just being yielded to Him. Being just obedient. Being a person that believes that His touch is present, that He's here. Hallelujah.
Because I tell you right now, you listen to me. I know without any doubt, I laid hands on you, the wind of the Spirit came. Divine strength, to be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being came. So you can understand how to move with God, how to be continually filled with the Spirit. Now, whether or not you walk in it and continue to go in it is your decisions. But the power of God, the authority of God rests upon your life. The cloud of His glory that goes to before us to take us to places that we've never been before. Not to go revisit territory that we were in last year. Or to continue on to reconfirm our little behavioral patterns, but to move us forward into every dimension of the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. You don't believe that, you can't have it. If you know, it's hard to get a person blessed that believes they're cursed. It's hard to get a person to move in faith that believes they're in, that continues, you know, that are just trapped in unbelief and doubt. God creates a mind change, an attitude change. He gives it by His power. You let the river of God flow through you and burst through you to where it's ecstasy in heaven. And whatever yoke's on you will break. You're not going to pout and doubt your way through the stronghold or the issue or the problem. You're going to shout and praise yourself through it. There is a place of shout and praise. Listen, there is a place of shout and praise that a breakthrough, a breaking forth of your spirit, a breaking forth of the Spirit of the Lord takes place. And when that happens, I don't care what's on you, it's broken off of you. Doesn't matter what it is, what kind of pain, sickness, disease, oppression, torment, whatever it is. The enemy will come into every one of us and try to place upon us everything that you can think of, everything that you go through, and everything that you're dealing with, and more. It's just that Father will teach us how to flow in the anointing where it's busted off of us. But if we're standing around all doubt, little mealy mouth, kind of, oh, hallelujah, mealy mouth. Oh, thank you, Jesus, mealy mouth. I really don't believe it, but I'm going to do it anyways. Ain't nothing going to happen. You're going to have to start acting like God's there. And begin to praise Him. And begin to worship Him. Begin to shout. And begin to lift up your voice. Because you'll learn, and it's not hard to learn when you've got this, when you have that kind of anointing around you, and that kind of anointing being modeled for you, it makes it really easy. I mean, it was so easy for the first century church. Everybody around them was moving in signs, wonders, demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power, living out the life of Jesus as they beheld Him. I mean, John comes on the highest level of authority when he says that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, our hands have handled of the word of life. For the life is manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. Now, in other words, he's saying, nobody knows it like I know it. Listen to me now. And he lays it out. Are you hearing me? He lays it out for us. Dear people, what a model. You have before you right here. I show you on this platform every time we meet how to step out of whatever it is you're in and to step into all that Father has for us. And sometimes it's a battle, and sometimes Satan tries to run, as it were, a roadblock, a spiritual block. Sometimes it's like running through a troop and leaping over a wall. Sometimes. Healed in Jesus' name. Sometimes. But the bottom line of it is, Father has given to us the strength and the ability to lay hold on the authority that He has to break through it. because he's training us to, in every way, dominate the satanic one. To tread upon scorpions and serpents and power, over all the power of the enemy. He's training us to be victorious over every spiritual wickedness. And if you're not willing to be trained, if you're just going to pout about it and doubt about it instead of shout about it, you're never going to be trained. You'll never be trained. Just let the thing overrun you and subdue you. You'll never be trained. You have to stand up and say, no to everything contrary to God, and yes to everything that God demands. No, it is the transition. It's a transition between not being able to be used in the kingdom of God and you're just a bench warmer. Or being useful, prepared in every good work. Hallelujah. Preacher said to me one time, he said, you're amazement to me. I'm just going to say, I don't mean this to sound as self-serving. I'm just telling you, you could do this too. He said, it's amazement to me. He said, I've never seen anybody go through as much stuff as you've gone through. And all you do is just dig a well and drink again. That's true. How do I do that? I don't stop worshiping. I don't stop praising. I know who God is. And if God be for you, who can be against you? Come on, man. Thank you, Jesus. Just so blessed tonight to see you guys, all of you worshiping, because that's really what it's about. You just get after kicking it up, dancing, worshiping. Be quick to hear God say praise. Praise me. Give thanks. Hallelujah. Come up here and worship me. Hallelujah. Come on up here and worship me. In the midst of all your problems and crisis, come on up here and worship me. In the midst of all the armies against you and all the things that beset you, come on up here and worship me. Come on, praise. Come on, lift up your voice. That's what he said. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for the wind of the Spirit. The wind of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for the great movings of your power in this place. Yes. Father, we thank you for the great demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Yes. Father, I pray right now for the young woman that came into the meeting tonight and sat in the back row weeping. Lord, and her friend basically drug her out. Father, I ask you to bring her back. I ask you to cause the seeds that were planted to bring forth fruit. We call her into the kingdom in the name of Jesus. I pray that every one of you find a place of relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ in such a way that you move with compassion towards everybody that you see. That you learn to love people in the first 3 seconds. And you love them on the level to where that you want to be able by the Spirit of the Lord to minister to their soul. Yes. You've been taught how to make friends and influence people to like you. You've been taught by an insecure and fearful world how to be insecure and fearful. Now it's time to let the Holy Ghost teach you how to walk in boldness and authority. Yeah. We just do this, people. We just do this. Excuse
give yourself to saying, Father, I want to be the servant of all. When you're praying in your day, give yourself to telling Father that you want to be, describing to Him the things that He's described to us. So, Lord, I want to be the servant of all. I want to walk in your lowliness. I want to walk in your meekness. I don't want anything going on in my life that's out of order. I want everything about my life to be everything about your life. I want to live your life. I give myself to live in your life. I will obey you and you live your life, Jesus. Because that's what it means to dwell in Him. I'll obey you and live your life. And of course, the emphasis on verse 5 is Jesus saying, without me you can do nothing, so here, live my life. You wake up every morning, you say, Lord, I give myself to live in your life. Holy Spirit, strengthen me, lead me, make me so sensitive to you. Where I don't do my own stuff, I don't walk headlong in my own will, I don't go run out here and speak my own words, do my own thing, live out my own pleasures, but to give myself to live it in your glory. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I give myself to being, having my feet shod with the same sandals that you wear, Jesus. Yeah. I give myself, O Lord, to wearing the same girdle around my loins that you wear, Lord Jesus. I give myself to putting on the same helmet of salvation that you wear, Jesus. I give myself, O Lord, to having the same breastplate of righteousness that you have, Lord Jesus. I give myself over to your glory, Father. I give myself over to your splendor, your nature, O God. And he sees, and he hears, and he knows whether you're serious or not. And the beautiful thing of it is, if you're not even serious, he'll make you serious. Just keep praying the prayer. But there's no reason in here that there should be such a yoke that someone cannot be serious. Because what will happen is you start praying this prayer and the things that you're too immature to be able to see right now that's holding you back, attitudes, decisions, behaviors, fit pitching, adults throwing fits. The spiritual display of a church not yet grown up. The Lord allows to see it. It becomes completely, terribly ugly and devastating to us. We go, I don't want to act like that ever again. And it brings us to repentance. It brings us to a place of brokenness where, you know, it's, you know, not me screaming and hollering at you saying, get it right. I'm going to parade you in front of people. You fall upon your knees in repentance. Because your heart is busted over your desire to please Him.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. I want to make sure that everyone of you understand what your job is. Your job is to show a lavish display of love to the people of God around you and to a lost and dying world that you encounter. A lavish display of His love. It's not even possible without rivers of the Holy Ghost flowing through you. Not even possible. Beautiful thing of it is to access the rivers of His glory and the rivers of His pleasure, the rivers that make glad the city of God, the rivers that every power of darkness fight against from being expressed in your life, is simply by the asking and the yieldingness. It flows that easy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I think one of the beautiful parts and dimension of this is that you fall so in love with the display of the power and the glory of God in your life that you don't want to touch anything or do anything that would in any way hinder that flow. And that's one of the great places of motivation and transition of maturity in our lives, where we're so raptured with His pleasure, so raptured with the flow of His glory in our life. We don't want to do anything to slow that down. We want more. I desire to see You in all of Your glory. I desire to behold You face to face. Very soon, Lord, I'll stand before You and worship You. And everything that's been valuable, that is earthly, will be to You a heartache. It will be to You an unimaginable act. How could have I done it? How could I have made any earthly thing of an interest to me? Just beholding Him, that's what happens. How could have I made any earthly interest valuable? So I want You to have wisdom. I want You to walk in wisdom, says the Lord. I want You to walk in divine insight and revelation concerning who You are and what God has purposed You to be throughout the ages. Make everything about heaven. Go ahead and live the life that you want to die and go to. Go ahead and live it in heaven now. Don't make it about money. Don't make it about you taking care of yourself. Don't make it about what all the rest of the nations and the lost and the unrighteous people do, where they seek after what they might wear and they seek after what they might eat. Seek after the things of the kingdom. This is what God is crying out to us. He wants to give us wisdom. He wants to give us insight so that we're not going to stand beholding Him going, I can't even believe that I made an earthly interest valuable in view of all this. I'm asking, and I cried out for the wind of the Spirit for you tonight so that you can behold Him, so that you can look into that realm of divine power and glory, so that you can have an encounter with Him. And I guarantee you, as you do, you will forsake everything and you will follow Him. You'll forsake it all. You will say, Lord, when do I get to go full time into the ministry? Oh God, you'll begin to cry out. The plea of your heart is, oh God, use me in a greater way. Oh God, I completely yield myself to You. I want nothing in my life except for the display of Your power and of Your glory. Becomes the cry of your heart. And I'm telling you right now, it's the sound of such praise. It's the sound of such praise. It's the sound of such praise. Heal her right now, Lord Jesus. Bring her here. It's the sound of such praise that heaven hushes to hear it. You hear me? You listen to me. You may not understand what I'm telling you. But that's the thing about God's Word. It's the thing about His direction. He gives us wisdom that goes far beyond anything that we understand. All we just do is do it. And now we live beyond ourselves. I tell you, when God hears such cries of the heart, all heaven hushes at such worship and such praise. Just that sound of, oh Lord, I want to fully live for You. Use me more. God, I want all those things, oh Lord, in my life that You died and purchased for me to have. A thirst for You, hunger for You. Let it arise so deeply. Forget about yourself, your disappointments, your discouragements, all the stuff that is about you, because this isn't about you. The only place that you and I are there is to live His life so that He can live in us. If you'll live my life, I'll live in you. What a covenant. What a deal. Therefore, I say, I choose to live your life. I choose to get up at 3:30 in the morning. But you know where that began for me? On the sidewalk out there preaching. I had no pastor telling me to go out the sidewalk and preach. I had nobody saying, you know, this is what you need to do. It's a fire in my belly from the day that I was born of the Spirit. There's a call of God in every one of you called. The Lord calls it to develop in your life. He calls it to develop in your life as you worship Him. Because for me, it began in worship. Began in just praising Him. Loving Him. Do it. Because what I'm describing to you is what the Word of God declares. And I'm just giving you, as one who's testifying and witnessing to these things, this works. Just do it. Jesus' name. Captivated, inebriated, caught away in glory, raptured in His love. Hallelujah. I believe one of the things that's important to do, and we'll set it in order in the near future, is to have a special meeting for kids that are between the ages of, right around between the ages of 8 and 13, right that age group right before they go into to Ruth Anna's youth group. And so, just, and it's really all about seeing them flow in the Holy Ghost. See them flow in the things of the Spirit, seem to be captivated by the Spirit, just really believing God for, you know, the right person to just minister the Word of God, not just, you know, some felt board story. Things of the Spirit. So you guys keep that in prayer with me. I want to see that happen. I want to see every dimension of every age group pulled more into the ministry, pulled more into the church family. Hallelujah. I'm so appreciative for your for those of you, your parent, that are parents who gave your kids over to the church and quit running interference between them and the church. Parents will blockade their kids from the church, thus blockade their kids from the anointing, and then wonder why it is that they end up where they're at. It's true. You hand your kids over to the church. I'll never dedicate another baby again in my life without reading to the people the full rights and responsibility that when they come to dedicate their children, they're dedicating them to give them over to the church, to hand them over to leadership of the church and take their hands off. They can do the right thing as they're taught of the church at home, but they hand them over to the church so that they don't end up in the world. Hallelujah. So they become an integral part of the body of Christ and they know how to flow. Huh? With the body of Christ. And they have church models, not just parent models. Amen. Because it makes a difference. Parents can try to dominate and control their kids at the point God can never even have them. It's a terrible thing. Act like they know what's best. And they've never done nothing. It's amazing to me how people can be so blind and so unwilling to deal with reality. They've never really done anything in the kingdom, but yet they're going to, you know what I'm saying? So I want to thank all of you parents who finally made the transition to say, I'm giving my kids to the church. Because I just see such fruit. And Ann and I were talking about it earlier today. Just so excited. When people begin to obey God, when they begin to trust God, when they begin to do God's way instead of their own way, you get out of sin, sickness, and disease when you start doing God's way. You start living the heavenly life when you start doing God's way. You start having everything that the Bible describes as soon as you start doing God's way. Amen. That's why I said to you, and I'm just going to say this one more time in closing. So I said to you on Sunday night in brief, sometimes when the equation's a little bit too complicated, you reverse engineer it. And you look at 1 John, forgive me, John chapter 15 and verse 6. He said, if you abide in me, if you live my life, and my word dwells in you, you will ask whatever you will, and I will do it. And so we have to recognize, is he doing whatever we ask? If not, then we have to understand then, is his word abiding in me? Is his word dwelling in me? Am I living by his word, in other words? I'm on in my life, the dictates of my life, I'm under the rule and the rod and the authority of the master's word. As a servant, it's what a servant does. Listen to the word, rule of the master's word. Am I living his life? And when we get truthful with God, the spirit of truth moves. When we get real with God, spirit of truth moves. It's the hardest thing is getting people to get real with God, to get transparent with God. We want to hold on to our own lives. We want to preserve our own honor. We want self-righteousness rather than his righteousness. Self-justification rather than the justification which comes by Christ Jesus alone. And in this place, we're going to continue to stir you up, putting in remembrance of these things. We're going to challenge you. We're going to get into your life. And if you do not give your children over to the church in this place, you have to leave and go to another church. If you do not give your children over to the church in this place, we will not allow you to stay. Your mama, your daddy, your granddaddy, your great-granddaddy can be in this church, but you can't be. Your cousins, your brothers, your sisters, and all extended family can be in this church, but you have to leave. Because you're going to do it our way. Or you're going to go somewhere else. And do your own thing in somebody else's house. But we're going to do what God says. We're going to build the pattern of his house just like he fashioned it. People can call it whatever they want. Call it control. They can call it whatever they want. Doesn't matter to me. We're going to be under the rule of God. That's it. Period. I told you 3 months ago I'm getting ready to get radical. I already warned you. We love you, but we love the move of God more. We are going to contend for the move of God. And we understand that God's word and God's ways are uncompromised. And we're not going to raise a church where we're not going to raise divisive people. We're not going to raise people doing their own thing. We're going to raise a church where everybody's one mind, one heart, has that kind of love, has that kind of agreement, has that kind of trust, one for another and for Father. Oh, yeah. We're going to raise
a realm of the body of Christ where we function like you're going to feel about everybody else like your right hand feels about your left hand. Both are glad to be present and more than glad. Amen. And I'm going to tell you right now, there's some people in here really need to go home and contemplate this, because I'm not just talking to the wind. Because I know. I know what's going on. Because the Lord shows us that which hinders. He shows us when we begin to pray and fast and cry out and say, God, what hinders? He shows us that's what hinders. Now deal with it. Now here's how to deal with it. And Father gives space of time. And he's merciful and he gives instruction. But still his eyes are full of fire and a sharp two-edged sword coming out of his mouth. And he stands with his priestly robes and kingly robes. Huh? Whew. In the brightness of his eternal glory. And he says, repent quickly. That's what he says. And we're going to do it his way.
Yes.
Amen. Because his axe is in his hand. And he's chopping down every tree that does not bring forth fruit.
Yeah.
And his winnowing fork is in his hand. And he's thoroughly purging his floor. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you know, some people take some of these things as just for the millennial reign, where he sits as a refiner's fire and a fuller soap. But I'm going to tell you right now, he does it in his house. Because he's reaching forth to bring something that shows forth the absolute glory of his person. That's what Father wants. And I want what Father wants. And you should want what Father wants. Because that's equivalent to doing the will of the Father.
Amen.
Equivalent. So all of our ideas and all of our personal preferences and all those things that we really firmly believe and we really think and all of our, you know, excellent insights are just going to have to be abandoned. And they're going to have to be disowned. They're going to have to be disqualified and even hated and even abhorred to lay hold of God's word and say, maybe you don't understand it, but I'm going to do it. Because it's wisdom and sight beyond me. You hear me? Because I'm speaking right out of heaven right now. I'm speaking right out from Father's will and from Father's throne room. And he's going to have his church. And he's going to have his people in the earth. And all the folks with all their ideas and all their wishes and all their wants and all their religious influences are going to have to figure out what they're going to do with their lives. Now and throughout eternity. But I've already sold out. I've sold out. And if it doesn't look like I sold out, wait till you see me next year. If it doesn't look like I sold out, just wait till you see what's going on here next year in this life. And I pray that you have the same spirit. That you have the same valiant consecration to heaven. Because what God has purchased for us is the best. I said Daniel down the other day. I said, Daniel, I will have nothing less in the church that we're planning out in Blythe. I will have nothing less than a reproduction of this. I will not have something else that someone else has dreamed up. They'll have to go somewhere else to do it. Because for me, this is just a pursuit of that which he demands. It's not the end product. It is a pursuit of that which he demands. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And praise God that he gives us the ability to get it done.
Amen. Yes.
And that there are people like you who want it, who don't want religion. You know, so many people come and they can't put their finger on it. They're like, what's different about this place? This place is different. What's different about it? It's a pursuit to be what he wants.
Yes.
That's it. It's a pursuit. It's in the atmosphere. It's in this little pulpit. It's in the carpet. It's in the microphones. It's in the lights. It's everything that we are. It's in the piano. And the guitar and the keyboards. It's in you.
Yeah.
But we love you. I'm sure that we will come back. I mean, we put our life on the line, but I'm sure we'll come back. And the reason I'm certain that we'll be back is because I'm not redundant. I don't like it that way. I think that we should be redundant. I just should think there should be tens of thousands of people standing up with the same passion right now. But just, the reality of it is, it's just not true. Too many people hold on to the world. They're holding on to their life in this world. Too many. Heal Jesus. Well, we love all of you. Anybody sick or diseased in your body, be healed right now in Jesus' name.
Be healed!
Jesus. I command it in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Well, hug everybody around you. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Hey, let me encourage you to do this. Everybody, listen to me quickly. How many of you like to go to Cuba tomorrow? Okay, I want you guys to buy yourself a ticket. Those of you that can afford, because some of you would say, well, you know, I can't afford it. I'd like to come, but I can't afford it. I want you to buy yourself a ticket and come with us by placing it in the offering. So that way, just continue to say that way. You say, I've gone beyond. I'm sure that many of you have. You've gone beyond. Just keep going beyond, because I'm going to tell you right now what God does. He works miracles. There's not a single person that I know who's ever outgiven God. Because when people begin to give on the level that is beyond themselves, all they're doing is putting themselves into a greater risk. And the greater risk is the place of miracles. The greater risk zone. As long as you're just playing, you know, marginal, keeping it safe in your safety region, safety zone, it's not much risk. But just go all the way with God. And everything that you do, just be radical. Anna, she's out for the count right now. But that's the best place to be. Her dad was either like that. He was either captivated on the front row with everything that's going on. My kids never played in church. They were captivated from the time that the meeting began till it ended. They weren't all over the place, fidgety and whatnot. They were either captivated or sleeping. Sleeping in the presence of the Lord is good. But at any rate, she starts preaching on the, giving a sermon to her mom on the Holy Ghost. And her mom said, that's radical. She says, I only preach on radical things. Come on. You decide, dad, you decide whether or not your children are going to be mighty in the earth. Dad and moms, you decide. You decide. You do it your way, they're going to be losers. Just write it down right now. You do it God's way, they'll be mighty in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So just do what's right.